It is time. So we'll call the Board of Selectmen to order. It's January 11th of 2017. And our first order of business is a very happy occasion. We have a painting. It's going to go on. Can I turn that over to you, Jim?
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman. Good evening, everybody. Tonight we have a special occasion. Deputy Chief Dave Clack will be pinned. I'm going to say a few words about Dave before we have his father pin. Dave graduated from Reading High in 1989. He has a master's degree in criminal justice from Western Wizard College. He's got a certificate in leadership from Suffolk University. He joined the U.S. Army after high school and served in the military as a police officer. He served in deployed in Panama, Cuba, Saudi Arabia, and Iraq. He was hired by the Reading Police in 1995. He worked as a night patrol officer. He was promoted to sergeant in 2005. He worked as a patrol supervisor. He was promoted to lieutenant in 2014, and he was in charge of the night patrol division. He was promoted to deputy chief in August of 2016. While in the department, he's been a RAD instructor, a RAD's kids instructor, a field training officer, a supervisor of the field training, the new hire coordinator, and the commander of the honor guard unit. And he's being pinned tonight by his father, Rufus Clark, who was a 1960 graduate of Reading Memorial High School. Come on up, sir.
Thank you.
I just wanted to thank everybody for coming out. Means a lot to me. I want to thank the Board of Selectmen and the town manager for once again letting us at your meeting. This is a very special moment for us. I've been very fortunate throughout my life. When I made sergeant, my wife Krista was able to pin me. When I made a lieutenant, my boys were able to pin me, and now my father's deputy chief. So it means a lot to have this and for you to take time out of your busy schedule. I know with everything going on, there's a lot going on. And I want to thank them for coming out. Thank the Honor Guard, which I've been a member of since 1997, for coming out for this event. All the Reading firefighters for coming out, thank you very much. And all the other Reading police officers showed up that are off tonight on their own time. It's my family and very close friends of ours that came out for this. I just want to say thank you very much. It means a lot to me that all of you are here for this. So, thank you.
We're glad to have all of you here, and especially glad to have you in your new role. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Honor God. All right. Hey. Boy. Oh.
Leave with you? Okay. All the party goers have left the building. We're at our own party.
No, all the back.
Why is everybody at the back of the room?
Yeah, I guess.
So, Chief Sagala is going to take us through the police department. I think we're going to handle dispatch too, is that right?
Yes.
Good. Okay. You're on, Chief.
Good evening, everyone. The police department FY18 budget. The overview. The police department budget request for FY18 is $4,777,250. Or -0.7% compared to FY16. Over 95% of the budget is spent on personnel. Wages. Wages are down 0.6%. For the FY18 request, the police department's budget for 41 officers. This is down from 42 officers in FY17. Two civilian office employees, a civilian part-time parking enforcement officer, a civilian part-time animal control officer, 19 per diem school crossing guards, and one full-time and one part-time ARCASA, ready calls and substance abuse personnel. Salary line meets all contractual agreements, which currently are under negotiation in direction regarding non-union compensation. Expenses. Expenses are down 2.1% for the FY18 budget. Now, what I'd like to do actually is skip over the dispatch section for one section. I want to go to the section where it has the graphs. See some of the information going on in the police department. Okay. Okay, so the first one's calls for service. We've averaged each year approximately similar amounts of calls for service for the last 3 years. Written citations, that's how many, 3,941 actual written citations the officers have written over the last year. Police stats, arrests, 130 this past year, 218 summonses, 51 protective custodies, which are alcohol-related. Motor vehicle crashes, we had 495 this past year. And overdoses, we had 45 drug overdoses this past year. Part one crimes. Part one crimes are the serious, most felonious crimes. We had 159 larcenies, 49 burglaries, 9 robberies and 16, 6 motor vehicle thefts, 4 aggravated assaults, 1 arson. We had 10 sexual assaults last year. Part two crimes. Family offenses, which are nonviolent, which are domestic, that usually are verbal in nature. We had over 130 last year. Vandalism, we had 76. Fraud, 76. Driving under the influence of alcohol, 51. Drug violations, now those are actual arrests for drugs, were 50. Simple assault, 46. You can see the list goes on from there. Property, now some single-digit crimes. Okay, incident reports filed. Those are actual reports. 1,786 that actual officers had the right last year. Detectives, 145 investigations were done by detectives last year. Now, investigations can be something from 2 hours to, it could take 40 hours to 2 weeks to do an investigation, depending upon what the investigation actually is. Here's something I added this year for this, is quality of life issues. These take a lot of time sometimes, but they're not actually, you can't actually measure how long and how, what we actually do on some of these calls, because quite honestly, they're not things that arrests are always made at or anything like that, so it's just things that take a lot of time for the police. Again, protective custodies, disorderly persons, substance abuse involving alcohol. We had 135 incidents involving alcohol this past year, and we had 133 incidents involving drugs this past year. And opiate, so substance involvement opiates, this is something new we decided to put in. We only have 13 shown there because we didn't start it until December. We wanted to have a new action code for just opiates because it seems to be such an epidemic right now.
Chief, that's in 1 month?
Yes.
Yeah, it didn't in 1 month? Correct.
What is that defined as, Chief?
It could be any opiates or any with heroin, Percocet, anything we dealt with, whether it was an overdose or we took drugs off of someone, or we get called for anything to do with an actual opioid drug.
And that's separate from the any crime element that might also exist.
Correct.
Wow. That's 1 month.
That was 1 month later. Yeah, that was just December of last year. Quality of life. 51 A's are child neglect issues. We had 17 of those this past year. Suicide attempts or suicides themselves, they're both, we had 23 this past year. Welfare resident check, $162. Missing persons, 17 for adults, 12 for juveniles. Unwanted guest, 26 this past year. That means if someone calls because there's someone in the house that they don't want them there, it could be a relative, it could be a friend. 209As are domestic disturbance orders, domestic abuse orders, so we had 23 violations this past year. And 258As are actually our orders amongst harassment prevention orders, which could be something one of us could get on another person, a friend, not a relative. We had 7 violations this past year. Okay, now if we go back to dispatch in the beginning here for a second. Sure.
Question. Back on the catalog of overdose, is there always a deceased in that case, or is that simply your call upon?
That's a call upon.
Yeah.
And that's both.
And the stats tell one story, and all of our eyes are going to out of year one compared to year two. But there must be a backstory here that comes from all of the time and energy and looking at it year over year. It doesn't necessarily come out with stats, but I'd be curious. Particularly in the case of the opiates, to hear some of that as well. I know you're here tonight with financials, but that drives, I'm guessing, cost in the out years, both directly and indirectly.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
It's one thing to just tabulate the number of overdoses. It's another thing to tabulate the intensity or the circumstances that surround it, or is it just the incidence that's growing, or are you finding that the intensity of it, the magnitude of it, that the number of people involved in it necessarily is also growing?
Yeah, we find our costs will be up after me, which is tonight, to have a small presentation. And we find the magnitude seems to be growing. Some of the kids now are getting younger and younger, seem to be dealing with it. Not just, not the 20 or 25, but finding 17, 18, 19 year olds as well with the opioids, which is something we didn't really see before. And we're starting to see more of.
And you would have juvenile statistics here as well?
I do, yeah. But I think we did for the overdoses are all into one.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. All right, so dispatch. Overview of the public safety dispatch is a 1.8% growth over the next year. Wages is 1.9%. There's 11 full-time employees, 10 dispatchers and one supervisor of dispatch. They're all civilian employees. Expenses are 0.0 growth for this coming year. And dispatch. Okay, dispatch logged over 32,963 calls this past year. And just in dispatch alone, they gave out 4,429 of the access tickets for the Reading, the depot, or the down at the compost this past year. Dispatch, they do everything. They have answered the phone 24/7. They're at the front desk when anyone comes in with any type of complaint. All the month of December and January, they give out many of those access tickets. They're all done during the month of December and January. And sometimes they're by themselves. We try to staff them at 2, sometimes 3, but a lot of times if we can't fill it, we're down to 1 on a midnight shift. The park enforcement officer last year wrote over $55,000 in parking fines in the past year.
Can he get it up 6 million?
We could try. All right. Support services, that's a unit this year that I have kind of beefed up with the help of the town manager. We decided this year to have 4 lieutenants instead of 3, so right now the breakdown of the police department is 1 chief, 1 deputy chief, 4 lieutenants, 7 sergeants, and detectives and patrol officers make up the rest of the department. So support services is a unique unit. They really support the whole department with training, with traffic control, the safety officer, the armorer, the fleet maintenance officer in charge of all the vehicles. The new position that I've implemented, the community service officer, all comes out of the support services unit. The armor and the fleet maintenance officer is responsible for processing all licenses to carry, as well as any issues, maintenance of all firearms, including recertifying all officers with their firearms and department vehicles. Last year, we processed over 216 new applicants for license to carry, which took about 81.8 hour working days of time this year. In addition to 216, there was an additional 50 applicants that were left over from 2015 that needed to be processed as well. The traffic and safety officer has many responsibilities. A few take up a significant portion of his day. During the school year, this officer is responsible for scheduling, training, reviewing, and payroll for all the town's crossing guards. Traffic and safety officer maintains all of the cruisers, traffic radar units, and maintains the certifications for all units. The officer is also responsible for all the speed boards and message boards that you deployed around town, which was over 70 different areas this past year. A community service officer, new position this year in 2016. The officer is the main person for the community liaison for the whole department. Over the past year, the community service officer worked as a liaison to the public regarding business complaints. On the third Tuesday of every month, lunch at the senior center with the senior citizens, handles all solicitor applications and badges, serves as the human elder services, protective services liaison, gave multiple station tours with safety talks to various Boy Scout and Girl Scout troops, performed civilian employment fingerprints, worked with Sheriff Contusion in the Middlesex Sheriff's Office to coordinate LEARN, which is identifying and protecting you yourself from existing and emergency scams for the elderly. Gave presentations at the Pleasant Street Center, Sanborn Place, the residents at Pearl Street, organized 4 Coffee with a Cop events, organized 2 rape aggression defense women's self-defense courses, re-implemented the helmet incentive through the summer, kids wearing helmets got citations for free ice cream and slices of pizza, donations from various businesses, was involved with the Fall Street Fair Committee planning of the Fall Street Fair, organized the Citizens Police Academy and other various activities. And I just put in also public records request. We have over 360 on average for the past 2 years.
Not that many.
Each year for the past 2 years. And that there's a new law that it was implemented as of January 1st, and it just made it more rigorous. And again, it can take any time from 10 minutes to 10 hours to look up people's past records and actually redact and go through the records and reports to actually give out to the public.
So somebody wants to know what their public record is that that's about?
Correct. Or if they have any reports that they want on anything that's going on in the police department, you know, that they that's a public record. Does anyone have any questions so far?
Yeah.
Kind of going fast, but go ahead.
So just kind of in general, a few observations. You'd be going into next year with one less officer than what you have now. But every statistic that you provided shows that, lack of a better term, business was up.
Right.
Crimes, larcenies, just wellness, you know, everything. Had more calls in 2016 than it did the year before. So, I mean, obviously, you know, the question I would ask is, you know, it seems like there'll be more stress, you know, doing more, and some of these things may be growing with less. And I know you're gonna say, oh, we're gonna do a great job, and you will. But this is one of the things I think the public doesn't see, is that, you know, when they call 911, you show up. You always will, whether you have 20 officers or 40 officers. But the thing is that it's, I think it's really important for people to know that you guys are doing a lot more, just in terms of more volume on the things that you normally do, plus taking on more things with a stressed, with less resources.
Correct.
So, I mean, that's just a general overall observation that I think it's important for people to know. And I'm really glad, and I thank you for putting these statistics together. Last night, the building department did a great job in showing us kind of what they do, and this is really helpful because I think it's really important for people to see, you know, that what you do drill down. And that, you know, less resources means that it's just going to be more stress.
Well, that's why I wanted to make sure we could get that out to you people.
Yeah, no, and that's important. Another question that I have, I know that one of the things that was going to be included in the override, had it passed, was the addition of a school resource officer, which obviously is now not going to be part of this.
Correct.
And it just seems to me that a lot of the sort of additional work is being done around sort of the health and wellness issues and stuff with kids. And so can you just sort of, you know, talk about how you sort of handle these on, you know, these things ongoing and what your plan would be to sort of, you know, address these needs?
Sure. So right now, over the past 4 months, the school resource officer has handled over 150 calls at the school himself alone in just 4 months. We're handling it the best we can. We triage. He's got the detectives as well as a backup, but quite honestly, he's definitely pulled from one school to the next, you know, which he doesn't get out to do a lot of proactive activities. He's much more reactive, just going from school to school, primarily at the high school, but from call to issue, because in one way, you know, 10 years ago, before we had a school resource officer, we didn't deal with the schools a lot. But now, since we've had it for 10 years, it's a great program. The school realizes it, and they call us for everything, which is great. Problem is, it's just we have one person now responding to a lot of those calls, and a lot of the calls are related to mental health and in minor drug activity. But a lot of it's mental health issues, and that's a lot of his day is tied up with handling issues with children that have mental health problems or home problems.
So you had indicated that you're getting more and more opiate calls, opiate-related calls in the younger ages.
Correct.
So, you know, my suspicion is that if we had another resource officer, you know, currently the resource officer I know spends most of his time at the high school.
Yes, sir.
Fair thing to say.
Yes, sir.
And so what that means is we don't have someone either at the middle schools or even the elementary schools for that matter to introduce the program, the resource officer program. And it seems like the trend is that that's where we should be. I mean, not that we can't abandon the high school.
Sure.
But, you know, it's this is one of the sad realities of fiscal constraint. So kind of tied to that, you're going to be down one. That for sure.
Yes, sir.
And retirements in this fiscal year? Are you expecting any?
In this fiscal year, there's two that could, but none are coming.
Nobody's
up.
Nobody's announced.
No one's announced, okay. Correct.
And so, how short are we? Let's put the resource officer on the side. How short are we really?
Bob and I had the discussion this afternoon. I looked at a staffing study done from 1998 of the police department. I found it today. And it says back in 1998, before we had the whole Walkersburg Drive area or any of the apartments in town, we should have had 44 officers back then. So, and that's with civilian dispatches, so nothing's changed. And now we're down, you know, back then they started to come up, I think they had 38, and now we're down back down to 41. So that was 19 years ago. They said before we had Walkersburg Drive, we should have been up to around 44.
And before the world was the way the world is today.
Yes, sir.
You know, which we're clearly experiencing.
Right.
You know, if you just extrapolate the opiate thing out to bank robberies, the convenience store robbery. I mean, you know, I know you can't necessarily always tie those together, but I know that there's a correlation somewhere along the line. I mean,
I would like to see us a minimum of 44 hours at this point.
So we're down three and a resource officer. Is that your analysis?
Yes, sir.
At a minimum. And that's 19 years ago.
I was going to say, and what happens if we do a study today?
Forward. That's why I say 4 to 8.
So, the frightening thing is that study, a study in a community like ours with all the things that have happened since 1998, the fact that we haven't had another study is a bit of a problem for me. I mean, I know we're not supposed to be spending money that we don't have, and we shouldn't. But sometimes you have to spend money that should be spent. You know, and public safety is probably, I mean, it's got to be the number one thing that's going on. And, you know, right behind it is the care, management, and education of our children. I mean, but kind of one is tied directly to the other, I guess, is what I'm coming for. It's interesting to get your perspective on, I mean, 19 years ago, they told us we need three more than we have. That's what I'm understanding. Is that correct?
Correct.
Mark, those assessments, I could imagine that they're done by headcount or households or some other basic demographic assessment. That
I'd have to look into the back of the whole report, but as far as I know, it's done by headcount and also demographic assessment.
But it must also be that, given that you're describing yourself as short, that the OT side of this gets stressed, as well as, of course, the need to fill, you know, somebody's sick, I got to find somebody, but they're already busy, just to help drug and try to find a backup. Is that really under stress? You can see the
This past year, we've had two officers out injured for a significant amount of time and another one that was out pregnant. So if we were three officers down for most of this past year, and that definitely put a strain on the department, because you're also trying to get people's vacation time and their own personal time to use and everything that, you know.
How does that strain show up besides people, you know, the usual mental state and so forth? Does that show up in terms of extra OT hours people are having to work?
We have to force people to work it. That's the problem sometimes. We actually have to order people to work overtime. So that's what happens, because no one wants to.
That's really the message.
Correct.
Yeah. And, you know, we can not have people and that's one piece of the equation. And theoretically, if you don't have them, you're not paying them. But the demands of public safety go on. So to your point, you know, you've got overtime that's, you know, that people are either embracing or being induced to. You got a problem. You got a safety problem, public safety problem. You have to fill it. So you begin to look at, I mean, it'd be interesting to look at what the overtime costs in relationship to the absence of the officers that you need. I mean, there's got to be a crossover place somewhere that says, if you get down too far, the amount of overtime you need starts to pay for one or two.
Starts to exceed it.
Yeah, it does.
Well, Bob, it has to. Remember, you took out the police officer and 20K went back in overtime. So.
Right. Well, and you know, that doesn't even begin to, I mean, one of the things I haven't seen up here that I know are soft costs are, you know, the times that we need public safety involved in a variety of town committees.
Right.
You know, I mean, all you have to do is think about the Fall Street Fair, for example, you know, which is, you know, there's a lot of public safety going on around that, I would imagine police and fire, and you've got to have people there.
Correct. I the community service officer involved with the public with the Fall Street Fair, probably a dozen meetings, and that was overtime because she works there, so those meetings are at night, and they have a contractual agreement.
I think we have to look hard at what the real cost of our diminished staff is, because I think it's greater than probably.
Right, and it's not just the cost of FTEs; it's the cost of the stress on the FTEs that are still here, and you know, not just doesn't go for the police department.
It goes across
all that, and that's just a cost of doing business that we need to factor.
So, Chief, I think John Arena had asked this earlier, but is it basically based on a ratio per head? Like, you need X amount of officers per whatever population?
But as far as I know, the staffing study is usually done by ratio and I think, quite honestly, also by how if it's a city or if it's a town community, how big of a commercial district they have, that type
of thing. Right, it makes sense. Like, you know, Walkersburg Drive comes on board, obviously that's going to trigger, you know, the need, even though those aren't residents coming in there, but that's activity coming.
Correct.
And I would think every time you have a major apartment complex or
it's kind of where I'm going. Right.
You know, that creates a that, you know,
and I know
it's different than single family home.
And I know we have some in the pipeline coming down. As well too.
Yep.
Be curious to see what that, you know, that ratio point is.
Chief, I'm ignorant of this, so I'll ask you anyway. There's no mutual aid in policing, right?
No, there is. Yeah. So if there's an issue, we can call another town. You know, it's not like the fire department. That's more regular. Ours is much more only for emergency basis. But we are sometimes called to North Reading or Stone or Woburn, or vice versa.
Was that elevated in our case because of a lack of staffing, where you couldn't cover it?
No, we've been pretty, no, I wouldn't say that, because we do have, even though we don't have a minimum manning in the actual contract, there is a amount, which I don't know if I'm going to say tonight, that is out there, that a minimum amount of officers that we do have on the road at all times, you know.
Yeah, well, that's not, yeah. That's, yeah, you don't put that out.
Right.
This is very informative and very thought-provoking. At
There's
the same
a ton
time.
Of work in this. I know it rolls off the tongue and you're done in 15 minutes, but I can only imagine the work. Behind. And I don't mean making the charts, I'm trying to correlate the data.
Sure, see me trying to make the charts.
The one thing that might be interesting is that one dimension of this, I think we're seeing drugs on a number of the slides. You're seeing it in the opiates, you're seeing it in violations, you're seeing it, I'm sure some of those larcenies are drug driven. I'm just wondering if you try to compute the total cost of drug abuse as it's measured by law enforcement spend, I think it would be overwhelming. Here it's diced up into five or six little bins. And you kind of, okay, that's up a little, that's down a little. But if you look at it as one big problem, and these are symptoms and not problems, I bet it's huge.
I would say almost everything we deal with is some type of substance related when it comes to arguments or and or lastings or robberies. It's all substance related nowadays.
Which speaks to the difference in what a study in 1998 would say compared to what a study would say in 2007.
I bet those charts look a little different.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Well, the drugs were different too.
Well, you wouldn't actually think of creating that last column.
Right.
I mean, I wouldn't think. I mean, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm naive. But I think that's not something that you would have been charted. And that's one, in fact, that's 1 month is,
right, that's
is unbelievable.
Chief, can you think, we're talking about manpower, but can you think of any technology ads that, you know, would assist with efficiency of the staff? Perhaps policing really hasn't changed fundamentally. It's still people contact, it's still enforcement. It doesn't yield to technology, but I don't know. I can't even think of a good example. Is there anything you can think of?
We're up to date with all of our cars have state-of-the-art computers, all of our line cars, I think, to the department, the IT department. They do a very good job of keeping our computers up to date in the cars. The only thing I could see, we talked about a year ago, was I could see coming eventually a body cameras. Things like that could be behind the scenes.
That might be mandated.
There could be an unfunded mandate someday from the state. You know, I could see them paying for the first round of cameras, but then all the associated costs with it.
The maintenance and on those
training.
Things.
Yeah. Right.
That's not a cost we want to have.
Yes, Bob.
The other thing that the chief can't show you, what the facilities director too, is he has similar programs and analytical programs with a lot of data, but it's not public data. So show
sure
right
how they use it is a whole different story, but it is becoming very much data driven. I just had a meeting with the chief and the deputy chief this afternoon with Jesse doing economic development. We'll look at crime and how it correlated. They have no shortage of data. We have two different, an internal system and then a data system that a lot of police departments use, and we can compare the peer communities that use it. Maybe what's there, 7 or 8 on that list?
8, yes sir.
So, you know, he's building up data, again, peer community-related data. I think if you were to do a staffing study today, it would be a lot more sophisticated than it was in 98. It would be more like a regression, not just this many people, this many cars.
Yeah, I don't think it would be a simple equation.
No, it would be types of commercial developments, type of residential distance from cities.
They would probably look at, you know, your location.
I'm sure the fact we're near two major highways is a huge amount.
Yeah, absolutely.
To that end, would you describe among peer communities as us being a hotspot or somewhere near the median?
For location, we're definitely a hotspot.
Right.
There's no getting around that.
Yeah.
Just because of the proximity.
Well, I mean, that's a driver in a lot of different directions. And certainly this would logically
be. This is a negative. Right?
I know that there are a couple of questions from the public, and I neglected to say in the beginning, just because we've been here so many nights in a row, I thought you've all been here that many nights in a row. I'll get to you, Nancy. We want you to feel free to raise questions and make this a bit of a dialogue. Obviously, the presentations are important, but we're not going to hold questions till the end of everything. The only thing I ask is that you do two things: stand and identify yourself, because we've got some sound issues that make the standing. Make you more heard. So, Mark, I saw you first, and Nancy, I'll be to you in a second, okay?
So, Mark Doster. Thanks, Chief. One of the things I wanted to highlight, and more for kind of information use, you did a nice job of talking about the cost of issuing licenses and permits and other things. And I think one of the things we want to do is to be able to take some of that data as we look at what our true costs are and then kind of reassess what some of those, how much we're charging. Because I think that we, in my mind, we've underestimated a lot of the costs. Thank you for
bringing
that
up.
Okay.
And yes,
Nancy. Nancy Doctor, Pearl Street. I actually have a question, Chief. I really appreciate you highlighting the quality of life issues that are taken up by the police department. In my understanding, a lot of our area towns are hiring licensed social workers in the police department. Andover is the one that comes to mind that I'm most familiar with. So I'd really be interested in a cost analysis of hiring a licensed social worker under the police department that would actually free up the officers, not necessarily for this budget, but going forward, because it seems like an enormous amount of time is being spent doing quality of life that perhaps should be for a licensed social worker that's under the auspices of the department. So I'd like that as perhaps in the future.
Yes, Jean.
Yeah, hi, Jean Delios, Assistant Town Manager. Just to that point, I just want to, and I'll talk a little bit about it when I give the overview on my budget, but within public services, we have two staff people under Human and Elder Services that they're not licensed social workers, but they do outreach work. So and they work very collaboratively with public safety, police and fire. And I don't know if that really shows up anyplace, but
I think that's hard to track, but I know that's that's a pronounced reality.
It's huge. In fact, one of the staff was saying the other day, we have a staff meeting, and she said, Gene, I'm on the police and fire cell phone. They call me regularly when something's going on. So we're very much plugged in.
Right under the budget, the one in Andrew Reynolds, budgeted in the police.
Well, my point is, we're providing that link. So I don't, you know, it doesn't really show up anywhere really pronounced. But it really is happening, and I'd be happy to talk about that more.
Yes. Chief, another question around the dispatch area. It looks like between last year and the year before, you took about 2,000 more calls, and you also handed out 3,000 more access stickers. So and maybe this is a question for Bob as well. Right now, the police...
300.
Did I say 3,000? Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Right,
yeah, 300. Yeah, that would solve a lot of problems. right now, I think the police station is the only place you can get the access sticker. And so if you've got people handling more calls and more, you know, and those transactions at the window aren't all 5 minutes. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer.
Right.
Does it beg the question that we need a second location? I know we're handling money and it's checks, but you know, give people an option to go to town hall, take some of the stress off the police department and the dispatchers to hand out the stickers. I'm not even going to get into the cost of the stickers; that's another item we can talk about later. But just the actual fact that you know to get the sticker, you know, you could be dealing with someone who's you know calling in an ambulance, and I'm getting my sticker. So, will that help you? And is there a way to do it?
I can start the conversation by mentioning a Board of Selectmen several years ago made it a very high priority to make sure to check that it's a resident getting the sticker. So the idea of some kind of fraud being committed and having a commercial or a non-resident come in and get a sticker is important. As a result, the police are the only ones that have those resources to go run a check on the DMV and see if you've got a license, see if you're a resident person. We can easily outsource this to another area, although not 24/7 the way
right.
they can. We can do, you know, during the day at town hall, the town clerk's window, if she's not listening. but we can't do that other piece. That
during
minute,
election
verifying
season.
The residency.
Right. Well, you show up with your license, your registration. I mean,
it's degree of, again, a past board was very adamant to have this department make sure it is a resident.
Well, if we raise the fees, maybe there'd be less fraud.
Yeah.
Was there problems before? Is that why the board was adamant about it?
I think there were more fears of problems than actual problems, but there may have been some commercial vendors that, you know, lawn service is not in Reading.
Where was the sticker got before? Just the police station?
I don't
multiple locations?
Anywhere else.
I think it was the police station.
Okay.
I think it was the commercial guys they were worried about. Because you might look for Reading.
Because we could do it online. You can't get that level of check.
Right. Yeah, you could do it online, but you can't. Nobody's looking at the license and registration.
Right.
And nobody really looks at that except a police officer or your designee.
Correct.
So that, I think, is where the issue is.
I might be here to look at it, see if it's really on
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chief.
Good
to have a brief presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Director of the Reading Coalition Against Substance Abuse. We are located at the police department and fall under the police budget, although we are currently grant funded. So we do receive support back into the budget for the services we provide and for our staffing costs. I'm going to just talk a little bit about some of the work that we've been doing, how we've been funded historically through grants, and then what our outlook looks like in the next few budget years. Currently, we have three executive partners through the town, so we work very closely with our police department, our public school system, and we are largely funded through the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, which is called the Drug Free Communities Program. Historically, the coalition itself was actually created by the Board of Selectmen. It was a call to action issued by the board. A group of community residents became involved along with town leaders and put their heads together, and what they came up with was, rather than trying to do piecemeal work, that there should be a strategic approach to the issue of substance abuse in our community. And so we now work using what's called the Strategic Prevention Framework. It's a public health approach. So we focus on projects that allow us to examine the data that's available, collect more data, plan, and then work towards implementing pilot and demonstration projects, evaluate those projects, and only continue what is beneficial to the community for reducing substance abuse. Our funding history, I've worked very hard to raise as many grant funds as possible. Since 2008, we've been able to raise $1.5 million in grant funding, and all of those projects have been completed. We did have a brief period of no grant funding because we had, in certain projects you have to wait, there's a time period waiting between applying again. And during that time period, the town did pick up the cost for our staffing while we were waiting for grants to come in. And that allowed us to continue writing grants and processing the information for future grants. Our FY16 budget was $220,000. That was for three grant projects. Those projects included a project to reduce underage drinking, a project on mental health first aid, and a project on substance abuse prevention.
So can you back up for a second? That one's expiring.
So we have two that have recently expired. The underage drinking project expired. It was a four-year project that just finished up this past fall. Then we had a two-year mental health project, which allowed us to train 608 adults in Reading in mental health first aid. It's an eight-hour training to help adults reach out and work with young people who might be experiencing mental health issues. And then our larger project is the five-year project. We are we have two more years of that project before that.
Provides, I'm guessing, probably the giant chunk of the funding.
The majority,
yeah.
Yes. So we, when we have more funding, we do more. When we have less funding, we shrink back down a little bit. And for right, moving forward in the next budget year, we'll be working off of one grant project. So the annual budget for one grant project is $125,000. That's through our White House project. That funding has been allocated by Congress, and it is renewed every year, but we do have an award through FY19. We will have the opportunity to apply for future grants. There are two federal grants that are coming up. These are highly competitive, although for the federal grants we've received, you have to score in the top 1% in order to be considered for funding, and we've been in the top 0.5%. So we're competitive, but it is still a matter of who gets the awards. So we will do our best. But we do also consider the cost benefit to applying for more grants, because they do increase the work on staff, and they also increase the amount of strain it puts on the finance department, because each funder requires reporting in different ways. They require things that we're not exactly set up for, and we often are twisting to create the work that they need. So oftentimes we have to weigh the benefit of, if it's a smaller grant, it may not be worth the application process. But that's something that we work with our board of directors, our chief town manager, and our superintendent to determine if a grant is worthwhile.
Erica, what would you estimate the total FTEs you spend on grant writing or grant support?
I actually have a workflow percentage to show you.
Just a number. I'm not looking for just round order. Is it 10%? Is it 50%?
Per week, you mean?
Of a year, in a given year. For 16, for example, how long, how much, was it a tenth of a person?
It's probably about 20%.
Thank
with
you.
Three grant projects. One project's a little bit less. Each project requires their own evaluation, their own federal reporting. My average federal report is around 120 pages, so they're pretty intensive, which is a good thing because you know, you're demonstrating what you're doing, but it is also an enormous amount of staff time.
And thus far, have you seen where Reading's results have been called out as exemplary or representative, such that it's either helped us in later grants or?
Yes, we've been asked to present at the national level three times for our federal funder. We actually presented with the director of the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Service Administration. And that is a huge honor in our field. And we have been in best practices books, which are shared with other coalition folks who are coming on and learning in the field. It doesn't help per se in the sense of if you've done X, you will get this grant, but if you have a strong strategic plan going into a funding application, you're gonna write better, you're gonna look better. And one of the things that we have with all of the work that we've been able to do is able to demonstrate what we can do with money. And that is very helpful because we're able to do the evaluation work, we're able to demonstrate how we can actually reduce substance use.
But all these grants are narrowly written around a scope and they're completely independent.
No, they're actually all interconnected. So we only apply for funds that will have an integrated effect. So the mental health project, it was actually an application that we did jointly with the school department and is related to a larger $1.1 million grant that they've received. So we do try to, what we're focusing on is building a multi-tiered system of support in our community versus a series of programs, although you may hear about programs.
That's huge, because I don't think that comes through strongly. People understand grants, they understand state or federal money, and they naturally think, like I just did, that these are kind of independent scope of work that you've got to deliver, that you're trying to knit these together in a holistic approach. I think it's really important.
Yes, and that's partly because of the support we have from our board of directors, which is 24 members of our community, represents 12 sectors of the community, and what they're focusing on in terms of supporting staff is not that we're just chasing the grant, but we're looking at how will this impact our mission, how will this benefit the community, and how will it actually strengthen the capacity of the town. And that's really what we try to do, is there's an equal balance in the grants we've applied for that are more focused on capacity building as well as services that we can provide.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Question, Mr. Chairman.
Sure, sorry.
Yes, Erica, you mentioned the state grants are expected, but maybe in the form of regional partnerships.
Yes.
How does that integrate with the other efforts that you described in the grants?
So we have benefited from being part of a regional partnership with some surrounding cities and towns for the last 4 years, Medford, Malden, Melrose, Wakefield, Winchester, Stoneham, and we've been working together on the opioid issue. And so we've been part of that grant process, which allows us to apply for additional funds. So by participating in the development of collecting data, looking at death certificates, providing education, we're now eligible for future funding. So you have to do the time at the table in order to make it to the next step. So we are well positioned for the next round of funding from the state, but it will not necessarily yield staff dollars. It may be in the form of program supplies, it may be in the form of training. So it's difficult to predict. There's a lot of federal money that's earmarked to go through the state, and then it's up to the state to decide what they'll do with those funds. When we apply directly to the federal government, we know exactly what we're applying for, but the state is more of a pass-through system.
Thank you.
So a few things that are on the horizon. There is a Sober Truth on Underage Drinking Prevention grant. We've had that grant for 4 years. It just expired. We are eligible to apply again this spring. There is a federal prescription drug prevention grant that's available in March. Again, these are nationwide competitions, so it's difficult to get, but we will try our best. Again, we'll look at the cost benefit. We'll work with our team to see what's the best approach in terms of applications. I mentioned a little bit about our board of directors. We have myself and a part-time staff person who is 0.6. She works 24 hours a week. She's our licensed alcohol and drug control counselor. And what she focuses on, I'll get into in a little bit, but largely a lot of case management for our diversion program, which requires a specific expertise in the area of addiction. And then we also have a part-time seasonal organizer who just fills in hours here and there to help with some of the administrative work. Our staff workflow. I spend about 10% of my time on planning and coordination for large projects, about 40% of my time public speaking and education. I do work in classrooms, work at community events. I taught 30 classes in youth mental health first aid in the past 2 years. Do a lot of work on data collection and analysis. We just tabulated the overdose data that you're able to see. Although we have great systems, it takes time to extrapolate the data, make sense of it, and also look at some of the demographics that are related to the data. Policies and programs and wells management of the grants is about 30% of my time. And then our 0.6 person, she spends about 35% on case management and education, and then about half on outreach, and then also resource and referral of residents who are calling in for supports. We have a number of different programs. I'm not going to get into a lot of the details because I know you have a lot on your agenda. But just so you know, we do a lot of community education throughout the year, and those programs are grant funded, but we are trained to offer the programs after the grant ends. And so what we try to do is always build in a train-the-trainer model where possible, so that even if the grant stops, we can still have that skill to provide to the community. Some of our long-term results, we know in the area of prescription drug use amongst young people, it has been going down. We have significant reduction in alcohol access because of the policies of the Board of Selectmen. We still have our challenges, and you see them from time to time. But what we do know is in our data that we get from our high school survey, we have more alcohol-free youth than we did before the coalition started. So we have 45% alcohol-free youth compared to 33% in 2005. We're really proud of the work around underage drinking because it's a difficult issue. Many adults sometimes see underage drinking as a rite of passage, and so it can be a challenge to work with some of the issues around, is it that big of a deal? But we know from some of the other issues which you saw in the police data, it can be a huge issue that can impact families and also create problems in the community. Our interdepartmental programming, we have a diversion program that was developed. We've been able to divert 167 youth from being part of the formal court system and from getting an actual court record through a program that we have that's a pre-arraignment system.
Can you describe over what time frame that 167?
Sure. This is the data for 4 years. We received 170 youth referrals for our program. And over that time span, we were able to divert 167, and three were referred up the court ladder because they required a higher level of support and services.
So on that topic, of those 167, because I know that you really keep close tabs of everything that's going on, of those 167 that took advantage of the diversion program, how many returned to end up in the court system?
The 167 have been diverted, so they are not in, they never entered.
So I know they never entered as a result of the incident.
They haven't reoffended.
Oh, yeah. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah,
that's
so right. They've been fully diverted in the sense that as of right now, they have not reoffended, yeah. Yes. Good. And they also have not had a second violation at the school level. So we track not just have they had court involvement, but also could they have had a school violation. We know the names very closely. We track to see who's out calling for services.
Why is that working so well?
It's a pretty comprehensive program. We have an education component. We have case management by our licensed alcohol and drug counselor. We provide oversight. Kids have to be accountable for what happened in the situation they were involved in. They have to complete community service. Together, these teens completed 1,300 hours of community service, and it's required to be performed in Reading because it's our program, and the young people, you know, were involved in incidents that impacted either a Reading neighborhood or a house. So we feel like all the pieces together really allow the young person to reflect and think about is drinking or is drug use something that's going to allow them to move their goals forward. A lot of what we talk about in the class that we provide a two-hour class that's a group education class and then individual case management. And what we focus on with the young people is what brought you to that situation that you ended up in? Why? You know, what choices did you make? And for a lot of young people, it's stress, it's family issues, it's peer issues, and they need time to be able to reflect on why they ended up in that situation and for them to not feel like they actually have control, you know? So it's a lot of support and education, I would say.
So this is a reactive approach. Somebody has referred, the incident's already occurred. Is there a proactive theme here with some of these, maybe you can't do it because of their minor state, but have some of these youth speak on their life experience in an attempt to head some of this off in the past with others?
We do enormous amount of proactive work as well. There's a lot of prevention work that's happening on behind the scenes. Each young person that completes the program does create an anonymous accountability statement that we can share with other folks to help in terms of education. But we also don't want to
stigmatize
that young person by getting them up in front of a community or in front of a school, because then they have to identify the, you know, some sure. really personal issues. So what we found and the research has found is that actually is not helpful for the young person or for the community. So what we try to do is draw the themes from their accountability statements and use them as a way to do education. But we also do bring in stories in other ways. We use storytelling a lot and true storytelling.
Are you doing anything with folks that are no longer minors, that, you know, had run-ins after, well after graduation in terms of, let me tell you my story.
Yes, we use a couple of those stories. We do a program at the high school on opioid prevention. We were just in the classroom today up at the high school, and we share a story from an alumnus who ended up addicted to heroin, and she talks about her story, and it actually was filmed in their classroom, so when they see her on the screen, it's like she's sitting there. And that's been one piece, but we also draw in other cases from the Middlesex District Attorney's Office in Essex County, because they're relevant stories, and young people who know the community and can talk about things that are very familiar.
Good.
So we do draw that in, but we also try to draw in the skills-based piece, because it's one thing to hear a story that sounds interesting, relevant, and compelling. It's another thing to actually have the skill to not end up in a situation. So you can know everything you could know. You could be a pharmacist and you could still struggle with addiction. So the thing that we want to emphasize is not just do you have all the education about the drug, but do you know what to do in the situation that you might be placed in? And we talk a lot about forecasting and helping young people plan around some of those risky activities, which could be a certain friend, it could be family fight. It makes them more vulnerable.
Erica, can you talk about the passage of question four, making recreational marijuana no longer illegal? What proactive steps you're going to take, and if you have the resources to do that, because you know the message is as well. You know, my parents voted for this, and now I can smoke weed.
It's going to be a challenge. We don't really have the full resources that we would like. It's a challenge for two things. Obviously, the harm perception is that young people sometimes perceive it as less harmful, and it can be. It depends on how much they use and in what format. But one of the things that we try to focus on when we're talking about any drug is people use substances to change how they feel. Why do you need to change how you feel? That's really what we focus on. When you get to the root and the cause of all of it, it's why are you using that to change how you feel? It doesn't matter what the drug is, whether it's alcohol, a pill, marijuana, it's why. And that's mainly what we focus on because that's the piece that we can work with. And it's usually connected to much more complicated things, family, peers. There's no easy... You know, but we do a lot of integrated work with our partners at the high school and at the middle school, and that's partly why we brought Youth Mental Health First Aid here, is what we recognize, and I apologize, Paul, my back's to you. Part of why we brought that project here is, you know, so much of what we deal with involves mental health, and we wanted to create a cadre of adults who are better equipped to deal with those issues, and I'll show you some of those outcomes as a result of that project.
The chart on the screen shows other schools that have had diversions, I guess, put through Reading.
Yes.
Is there, we're talking about budgets, is there any dollars attached to those in terms of?
We do charge a fee for anyone who's out of the community. Austin Prep students we do not charge because they're in Reading. Mm-hmm. But anyone who does not live, work, or go to school in Reading, we do charge a small fee. It's a $50 fee for them to attend the program.
And that's paid by the individual, the parents, the town?
The individual, if they're over 18, the parents, if they're under, and that gets deposited into an RCASA account for donations. It's a revolving fund, but it's a very small portion. We only accept kids from outside the community if we have space.
I have to ask this. Do you foresee any case where this might be something that could be even partially regionalized?
Yes, we've been asked. We're actually we were the first program in the region to start. And I've spoken in 11 communities, all the way up to Ashland, who've asked to model the program. And when we've been asked to regionalize, we've continued to say no, because we cannot fulfill the need. In order to do a diversion program regionally, you have to be available to those kids and those families, and we don't have the staff support to do that.
But Erica, is it a fair statement that you work closely with the school resource officer?
Every day.
Okay. The chief, as you probably heard earlier, has said that because of the override not passing, we were not able to fund an additional position. Can you talk us through how that's going to affect your work?
I mean, I was a huge advocate for involving a middle school resource officer. I think the work that the SRO program has done for Reading has been enormous. I work with Officer Mulo every single day on projects. He is a trainer in mental health first aid. He and I teach together in the classroom. Having a middle school SRO or having more SROs is invaluable from a prevention perspective, because the SRO role is really supposed to be that the person is a resource officer someone that the young people can come to and ask questions of. And when you have less of that, then you have less opportunities for those young people to come forward. And they love the opportunity to interact with an officer in a different way. You know, it's a great way to build relationships. So I would love to see us find the resources. I'm always looking out for grants, and I'm always letting the chief know if I see or hear of anything, and always try to build in work where I can in our projects for officers. So you can see that we do have a small amount of people from outside the community, a small amount of kids who are in college. Those are kids that have maybe gone off to college, come home, and on break may have gotten caught with a substance. But the majority of the program is really geared to helping the high school and helping to divert them as young as possible from getting into the court system.
Is tobacco a problem anymore, or is it just off the radar?
It is a problem. So what we worry about is the nicotine, which is the addictive component. We also worry about tobacco from the sense of cancer-causing chemicals. But what we're seeing is an increase in vaping or e-cigarette use with nicotine liquid, and young people are using larger amounts of nicotine because of the way that vaping occurs, and they're getting addicted faster to nicotine. Yeah, so we're doing a lot of education around that. Just to get you an idea of, it takes a lot of time to get the word out to the community about opportunities that they may have to be part of substance abuse prevention, and also to just have people get on board with some of the more complicated issues. So for example, our medication collection program called RX Roundup started back in 2010. You know, the first year we collected a little under 2,000 bottles of prescription medication. In 2016, we're almost up to 7,000 bottles. So it takes time to build awareness.
7,000
bottles. It's 1.1 million pills.
The CVS notice?
Yes.
So did you hear that last number?
1.1 million pills.
1.1 million pills.
And that's just what people are turning in. That does not include what we all have around the house. So one of the things that we came up with, because we definitely have folks who are more homebound, who may be unable to come down to the police station and drop off their medications. We've recently purchased a number of these doTERRA pouches. These are pouches where you can take a bottle of medication, put it in the pouch, mix water in it, shake it up, squeeze it, and it can go right in the garbage, and it's biodegradable, and it actually deactivates the active ingredient in the pill. So there's no safety issue with putting it in the garbage. So these are being handed out to on any overdose situation. So the parents of someone who might have overdosed can get rid of any other medication that might be in the home, and they don't have to worry about anything. They can put it right in the garbage. And then also Hallmark Health home care providers are taking them to their clients, and then we'll be working with the senior center to hand them out, because then they won't need to worry about bringing them in. So I'll pass that around just so you can see one of the another project, Mental Health First Aid.
How do we get these?
Those we purchased through the grant.
Right.
Yes. And they're $4 a pouch. so, but it is one of those things, it can save a life. So we want to do what we can to try to get those medications out of the home. The first access point for young people that abuse medication is in the home. In 2015, we started our Mental Health First Aid project. We had to train 10 people, including myself, to be able to teach the curriculum. It's an 8-hour training. There's 3 different courses that you can take. We have an adult course for adults helping adults with mental health, a youth course, adults helping youth, and then a public safety course where we train officers. In 2015, we were able to train 277 staff and refer a little over 140 young people to services. In 2016, we were able to train about 320 adults in first aid, including our public safety officers, and we referred about 212 young people to services. So with training comes more support for young people to get to the services that they need.
Do you have any idea of the hours that are represented in those green bars? So if you had 170, how many hours is that total?
It's
immeasurable.
It's immeasurable. It really is. Because it's the people that we trained 350 school staff. So you could be an educator, you could be a secretarial staff person, you could be someone who is a coach. So they may have an ongoing relationship with the young person. It may take 2 weeks to get the young person to share what they're concerned about to then go ahead and make the referral. So it's really that relationship building piece, which is why we train the people that interact with young people the most. Our public safety officers went through a specialized training, and their training specifically focused on their own stress level, post-traumatic stress disorder involving police officers who witness shootings or who have been shot, because they have a higher level of obviously encountering high violence, and then also what to do in situations with folks that are having mental health issues. We have applied for other grants, including trying to fund a clinician at the police department. There is a Department of Mental Health program that you can apply for. We have applied for that. We were not funded. Wakefield does have that program, and we've been modeling some of the work that we can off of their program. But one resource that we do have is a mobile crisis service that is regionalized, and our officers can call the mobile crisis service to respond to mental health issues if the person consents. So there is no getting around the police responding. Police still have to respond. But then if the person and the family is willing, we can call in mobile crisis, and a clinician can come out, do an assessment, and provide services. And that also goes for children. So right now in our schools, we call mobile crisis. The mobile crisis team comes, works with the child and the family to provide services. So we are using the resources that are available to us. But with mental health issues, we could always use more resources. We do have one really exciting resource that has taken a lot of hard work. It took about 9 months to plan and develop getting into this project. There is a service through William James College called the Interface Referral Service. One of the themes we heard in working around this issue was the barriers that people face in accessing mental health care were significant. You could call and not get an appointment for 8 weeks, then you get the appointment, they don't take your insurance anymore. Or you're not sure what you need. Someone says your child is depressed, but you don't know, do they need a psychiatrist, a psychologist, a licensed clinical social worker? It can be complicated. All you know is that your family needs help. So by contracting with William James, the town has been able to provide this resource free of charge through a grant that we have. And what it offers is you can call, a licensed clinician answers the phone, you give them a little bit of information, they do an intake on what you might need, what your concern is, and then they call back with matches that are appropriate to your concern and your need. The trick with this is they call back with matches that have available appointments within 2 weeks of your call. That's the trick. Because anyone can give you a list of names, anyone can say, geez, these counselors are great. But it's difficult to know who has availability, who can see a 14-year-old that's depressed, that speaks a second language, that doesn't have a dad at home. That's the kind of specificity that they can provide. We rolled out the program in November. We received a small donation from the hospital trustees, a $2,000 donation towards the project, which is really much appreciated, and the rest we've been able to cover through the grant. But in 1 month, we had 12 families matched with mental health services. So it's very, very helpful service. Our surrounding communities, Wakefield and Woburn, also have the service, and in an average year, 170 families are matched with services. So we're looking forward to continuing to offer this. It can be for any age, so from children to the elderly, and it can be around any issue. So those are a little bit about our services, our budget outlook. I can answer any questions.
So I do have a question about, early in the presentation you talked about some grants that are gonna expire in 19.
Yep.
So we're two fiscal years out on that.
Yep.
The current budget that we're discussing and the next one. Where are we on the continuum of being able to reapply? One of those I noticed is a really large.
Yes, one program, the $125,000 per year project, which we're currently funded on and will be for the next 2 years, you reach a max of 10 years of funding and you can no longer apply for that particular resource.
Where are we on that continuum?
We will be done in 2 years.
So that's it.
Yep, so that is it. There may be other funding sources. We don't know yet what that's going to look like. All we know going into this next year is that there's two applications, one for $50,000, and we don't know the amount of the other yet that could come out, and there may be some state funding.
And what about the $625,000?
That's the one that ends in 2 years.
Yeah, that's not great news.
Yes, it's not great news. But we have squeezed every dollar
It's not a challenging question.
Yeah.
It's just a concern that, you know, we're going to have to put that on the radar screen because you can't stop doing what we're doing.
Right.
But you got to pay for it.
Yes. And one thing that is not always noticed about the projects that we do, they all require a match donation or a match in-kind support from the town itself. So for all of the grants that I described, that $1.5 million, $817,000 town dollars had to be provided somehow.
In order to get the
1.5. So our office space, the supervision, oversight, all the work that the finance department does, we have about 25
So calculations
components.
Are made around all those
yeah.
soft costs.
Rental of space, all that kind of stuff. But it's significant. Without those resources, as a coalition, as a staff, we could not operate.
Right.
So just so you know the true cost, how much the town has invested in our work.
Great. It's very thorough. Any other questions?
Go ahead.
Erica, would you consider putting your fees for the diversion program in line with the private sector, either billing insurances or raising it to be a little bit more competitive to what you see in the private sector?
We've discussed it. One of the challenges is twofold. Municipality, there's limitations in terms of what you can charge for fees, and it's not necessarily comparable to the private sector. In fact, it's much, 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 much lower than the private sector. In terms of billing for insurance, diversion services are not always billable. In fact, most are not. There's a very small component that can be. We are looking into any available options for billable services, particularly around screening at the school level. But right now, we're not aware of any services. The contracted diversion programs that do have billable services are for more advanced forensic psychology and psychiatric services. So they're much further up the line. As a pre-arraignment program, we're not quite there. But it is something we've looked into for sure.
Erica, so it seems like your budget is a fluctuating one, depending on what you have for
yes.
the grants. However, the problems that you deal with are not just that. They're not only the same, in a lot of instances, they're increasing. Have you ever, it'd be nice if we had, mm-hmm. have you ever kind of run some numbers to say, if we were getting this on a continual basis, we'd be in a lot better position to keep up with the demand that's out there.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a number that you have that hits that yearly?
We have done a strategic plan that kind of looks out. The way that we look at it is we're successful if the other pieces of the town have more capacity. For example, I would advocate for a middle school SRO before I would advocate expanding the coalition.
Okay.
Because that SRO is going to provide the service to a larger number of young people than maybe we could reach through a smaller project.
Sure, hopefully hit them before they get to.
Exactly. So we try to be strategic. From a staffing perspective, having two full-time staff has been the most beneficial from an RCASA standpoint. We can do more with more staffing. But it really is around getting the strategic pieces within the policing, within the school, and within the town working the best we can. Having the interface referral service, it's 10 licensed clinicians answering the phone every day. We could not provide that service
right.
in-house, affordably. So there are some services that, we try to be creative about.
Because it almost seems like there could be some core services that you really need to focus on year in and year out.
Yes.
And then, above and beyond that is some real nice to have.
Yes. And then there's a lot of work we're also doing with parents and volunteers, A lot of parents are challenged by the society we're raising our children in. It's not an easy world to be raising our kids in. So having the opportunity to do more work with parents would definitely be something that would be beneficial. We're doing that in a small way right now, teaching some active parenting programs, but that's an area that we'd love to expand.
It comes down to hours in person.
Yes, because it's day and night.
Right.
So order to reach parents,
So can we come back to the resource officer, a second
yes.
resource officer for me? I'm interested in your professional opinion about the impact that would have on inroads, into prevention. And do you think there's a way to quantify the value of that?
We've talked about the value that the SRO program brings just to the high school level, and it's three pieces that what we see. It's the visibility that there is a trained person that you can trust in the building. One, it helps with young people feeling safe, especially in this environment.
Mm-hmm.
There is something always on the news, and there are young people who are anxious, and they should be, because of what they see, and so it's difficult. So there's that one thing of the presence. The second piece is just the ability that they have to connect with young people, because we've been great in terms of who we've been able to get into these positions. And then the third piece is the training and education that they provide. It's enormous. And them working as part of a team, because they're working on the school safety team, they're working on emergency preparedness, they're working across all of the different aspects, the ALICE training. There's a lot of work that's happening district-wide that our SRO currently does that stretches him more thin. The other piece at the middle school level that is a challenge is not having a health education program. So there's two pieces that I
so
would
see. So
that's
a piece that we've taken out
because
2 years
of funding,
ago.
Yeah, yeah, you know, so having middle school health education and a middle school SRO would enormously help that particular level. That's definitely a gap that we see in our
so
in
it
our
sounds
data.
Like, you know, your estimation is similar to the one that Chief Segala just shared with us, that, you know, there's a downward push on this problem from an age standpoint,
yeah,
and we're not addressing it.
And the piece that folks sometimes don't see behind the statistics, so for example, Chief Segala shared the overdoses. We've had 75 overdoses in the last 3 years. Those are overdoses that our fire department has had to respond to. 34 people passed away, so, you know, those
34
are
of how many?
75. So 34 families have been impacted by that. 75 families went through that situation of dealing with an overdose in their family where the person was brought back by Narcan. And of those situations, 7 siblings found their loved ones and called 911. 7 siblings who are young people in our schools. So it's not just the incident, the call, it's then the school is also dealing with the aftermath of the family challenge, you know. So, and that's not to mention the number of parents who are in pain over all of this. So it's complicated, it's a lot of interconnected pieces. But that's why having a team where we work so closely with the police department and the education system is really helpful.
So we lost 34 in 3 years. How many in 2016?
I don't have that number off the top of my head.
But several last month.
Yes, yep.
You know.
And I think you saw in his statistics too, a little bit of a spike in 2014. That was when we saw fentanyl come onto the market, and so we saw a spike in overdoses. We started to see it come back down, and it's gone back up. We're seeing a new strain of fentanyl coming out of China that's spiking things back up again. But in comparing ourselves to other surrounding communities, we're a little bit lower, but that doesn't give us any comfort when we've lost one person. You know,
yeah, that does
one
nothing
person's
for
enough.
The 34 families.
But what we are trying to do regionally is look at some of the issues underneath all of the overdoses. So what we found looking at our 7 communities that we work with is that 46% of the overdoses involved adults working in the trades. So adults that are dealing with chronic pain from their job. And so one of the things we're working with is the Sheriff's Department, the unions, 3 statewide agencies, and a national agency on how to create better resources through the unions and non-union workers to help laborers, because they're really hard hit by this particular issue, as well as athletes have been. Mm-hmm. So having the regional work is very helpful in terms of seeing the much bigger picture, but none of that helps in comforting a family. You know?
You seem to be going in that direction towards transitioning from prescription opiate to, when you talk about pain relief, I assume that's where you're going.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, they start on obviously something
right.
prescribed. And yeah.
You said earlier, though, that you always come back, I'm going to misquote you, you come back to the core question, why do I feel the way I do? Why do I need to take a drug to make me feel
better? Yeah, why do you need to change how you feel?
Do you find that, you know, I like to think of things as either problems or consequences of a problem. It feels like what we're describing here is a consequence, and the real problem is, how do I feel about it?
And that's why we always come back to that. It's the same reason why adults use.
And so has that problem changed, has the problem statement of how do I feel about myself changed since you've been involved with our pathway?
We're seeing young people, I would say over the last 2 years, have less coping skills.
Really?
Yeah.
Would you attribute that to social media, things like Facebook,
Twitter?
I think
social media makes it enormously difficult. There is no bubble for a child right now to escape. You know, you can shut the phone off, but 3 friends are going to tell you what they said about you on Instagram. So it's very, very difficult.
Well, I think that routes back to the discussion about the resource officer.
Yeah. The scrutiny
because,
is intense.
You know, when Mike is at the high school, there are hundreds of kids that actually know he's an island that that they can go to.
Mm-hmm.
The kids in our middle schools and our elementary schools don't have, I mean, his time there is so limited just because he's one person.
Right.
These are some of the unintended consequences of budget discussions, in my opinion. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Eric.
These are just some copies.
Okay.
And so, Chief, you up?
Oh, we didn't get these earlier.
Where are you? And the budget is already there on the bottom right.
This is page, oops, just jumped right to marks. Thanks for having me here tonight. Reading Fire Department has four major functions: fire suppression, fire prevention, the emergency medical system, and also emergency management. But tonight, well, last time I presented to the Selectmen, Selectman John Arena asked for some data on a specific item that was trending. And last night there was talk about ambulance bills, ambulance billing, revenue, and things like that. So I thought I'd just put together a couple of slides to show what's trending in EMS on our response side and also on the revenue side. So if we look at our responses from 2010 to 2016 calendar year, see that the responses, the request, is trending upward. And we don't transport everybody that calls us. You know, you might go to a car accident and somebody's not injured, or somebody has fallen. We check them out, they're fine. You don't need to go to the hospital. So if we look at our transports also are increasing. Yes, similarly along the same rate.
So if you could bounce between those two slides, okay. It looked like the calls were down, but the transports were up.
No, the calls are trending upward. In 2010, we did 1,800, and 2016, we're up over 2,000.
15.
What happened in 2012? Everything bounced up.
There's always highs and lows along the way. It's still an upward trend.
Yeah, it's... You'll, 1 year to the next, it might dip a little bit.
Right.
The trend is...
It's continuing to be at more
right.
if I
went back, we started providing the ambulance service in the 1970s. If I went all the way back to that, it would show that.
It would show a rise.
It's only 10%.
Steady rise. The off years. No, I just thought it was interesting that there was a drop-off of, looks like 200 calls, but there was an increase, substantial increase, of transports.
Correct. Yeah.
Is that because it's less car accidents? Or?
No, who knows? There's just variables from year to year. And we go to a lot of car accidents. You know, with our location, you know, they're up on the highway, 28, 129. We're just right in the middle of major transportation routes, and we're constantly responding to car accidents.
So, Chief, from a billing standpoint, we're really only billing on the transport.
Correct.
Not on calls.
That's correct.
So there's a lot of times where you're going out there and there's no money coming back in from that.
So if there's an accident on 95, does it have to be between certain areas before we respond, or does the state police make that decision? How does that work?
Generally, we get the call from the state police. And technically, on Route 95, Reading is only around the Cloverleaf area. It goes from the Cloverleaf of 93 to the Cloverleaf of
95. Of 28.
Right. But it's
pretty small.
Generally, we get calls from Route 129 to 93.
Right.
And there's always a question where it is. There's never really good data. Even if there's a police officer on the scene, it's not great data exactly where they're located. So if we get the call, we will respond. If we think it's in another community, we'll notify that community. If we get on scene, somebody needs medical attention, we'll transport that patient.
So if you roll and there is no transport, there is no reimbursement?
Correct.
Okay.
Sometimes we go to a person's house And they may want to go to a hospital in Boston that it's not an emergent type of, we'll call a private company to come and do that transport. So we're not tying up our resources for something that we're really not going to treat in the back of that ambulance. So if you look at our ambulance revenue, that's trended upward as well. The last 2 fiscal years, we've increased our ambulance rates, and that's one of the reasons. The increase in runs also is a part of that.
Was that fiscal year 14 that we increased that?
I believe it was.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And so are we, how would you prepare us to the market?
I've done a study, I did a study with ambulance rates back, I'm going to say March of 2016. And there can be real variables among our communities. Some of our communities is quite high. And I had a number of discussions with our ambulance billing company. Where our rates are basically based on Medicare rates plus 125%. Some communities were much higher than that.
I would think that would be low if they're basing it on Medicare rate. And then,
well, they generally all do that.
Yeah, but their percentage of Medicare of markup is different.
Medicare is just a...
It's a reference.
It's a very low point. It's a reference. And it's really lower than what I think costs to provide the service.
Great.
The ambulance billing company, they charge us 4% of the revenue they collect. The information I got back from the person was that they recommended that we increase our rates to Medicare plus 150%, and that would generate she estimated around $44,000 per year.
Based on the same number of calls.
Yes, for that fiscal year, she was based on in that fiscal year. If we had raised it, we would have gotten about $44,000. But when I look back on that, what we brought in, she was a little bit high on her estimate. So I think the real number would be somewhere in the 30,000.
By making range. That,
but if we
the
made
25
that
basis point bump.
Right. But what that will do too is if it's beyond what the insurance company will pay, then they'll pass that on to the patient.
Right.
And I was going to show you some data in the next slide.
And then you have
slide.
Collection issues, which the provider is dealing with, I guess. I mean, it sounds like 4%. You could pay that much on a credit card provider, so they're actually making all the collections. And
well, Chief, right. you used to send the bills out yourself, if I remember correctly.
We did, yes.
So not a great use of our Chief's time. So.
Well, I didn't personally.
In the hours of 1 and 4 in the morning.
That's right.
I bet it cost a lot.
This is a very automated system. Right now, the firefighters do a patient care report on a tablet. It gets emailed to the hospital, it gets emailed to the billing company, and then they'll probably get it up within a day or two. So it's a very quick process, which is kind of important with car accidents, because there's a certain amount that the insurance company will pay for medical. So if they get it in quick, they will be reimbursed for it.
Yeah, it's just kind of a quick turnaround. It's almost like an automatic.
Correct.
We talked earlier this week about municipalities having to justify their fees based on costs. In our discussion of 2 years ago, and just briefly a moment ago, when you said we talked about what the peers were at, do we have actually an idea of where our rates are relative to our actual costs?
It depends on how you, it's math, so you could calculate it, but it would depend upon how you want to do it.
You're comfortable where our costs exceed the rate we're charging?
It's actually a question of how would you staff a fire department if you did not offer the service?
So we wouldn't have that. So it is the full cost in that assessment.
It's not, at the current price, it's not fully costing.
Because we wouldn't have all of our firefighters with EMTs.
We wouldn't have
EMTs.
As many firefighters, don't
correct.
Ask me how many different. And we would not be hiring
our equipment wouldn't be as sophisticated.
But in that example, it's truly the delta between with and without,
yes.
And that's what you can charge.
Yes. That's what I would argue.
That's what I would argue, too. But I wonder if it's time to look at where we are in the peer communities and evaluate it again. These rates are going nowhere but up generally.
Right. I could do another study. I looked at the last time about 10 peer communities.
Right.
And I did that for Finance Committee.
Yeah, that was the last budget year.
Are we in the middle, roughly?
It wasn't nearly as compelling as the time that he brought.
We looked at it 3 years ago.
Yeah, it was low.
And I remember when we raised it, I think the strategy was to raise it to just be a little bit below the median, not to be above. And so we're still below the median. So if we brought it to the median.
Well, we're probably more substantially below because we haven't made a change in 3 years, roughly. Is that right?
No, it's about a year and a half.
Seems like it. I seem to remember it.
But then if you reflect that, in fact, our limit is not the median, but the actual cost for the conversation with Bob, you actually may have more headroom than you think.
And you know, this isn't an exercise in trying to torture you with, you know, chasing down numbers.
This might be an area where there's
obviously
more.
Obviously, in a budget discussion, we've got to really, particularly in the environment that we're currently in, as we continue to say, we have to turn all the all no stone and go unturned.
Absolutely. My only thing that I wanted to point out was that. When I did the study for some communities, the rates were extremely high. It might be $2,500 for an ambulance transport. So it's probably someplace you wouldn't really want to go. You know, ours might be $1,700. You want to go that high? And because what would happen is if you go very high, then see this number here. If you this chart is where our revenues are coming from.
Right.
In the blue numbers are fiscal year 2016. The yellow is 2015.
Right.
And you see that the self-pay area is going up. And that's because people's insurance is changing on them. Their deductibles are going higher. And so that's being pushed onto the patient. So you would definitely see that go up if you were charging at the higher end.
Just want to make a point that we made the other night, that these revenues go to the general fund. They're not kept within the public safety cost center.
That's
so
correct.
They benefit all sectors of government.
Correct.
So roughly one third of those revenues are redistributed back into the town side to pay the bills for the delivery system. So if you stop to think about it, you do a cost benefit analysis. I mean, try to think about this like a business for a minute, and think about if you have an ambulance service as your business, and what ends up happening is that you have revenues and you have costs. So you have fixed costs tied to the, tied to just be maintaining that ambulance service, and you've got some variable costs tied to frequency, how often you're doing it, and then you have revenue streams. And the theory would be that you'd bring the revenue stream back, and it would offset. I mean, I don't know that we're looking to make a big profit, but it would offset. But it'd be interesting to see, given the current equation, where we really are. My
exactly.
suspicion is because, you know, two-thirds of it is redirected in a totally unrelated way to these expenses. You know, what is the cost benefit, you know, tied to this thing? Bob,
yeah? Yeah, I can tell you, not surprisingly, I've done that. When we started to hire paramedic only to offer advanced life support, we added an element of cost to just the fire department budget. To run it more like a business, you'd have said, okay, from now on, that additional cost from this day forward is first paid by revenues, and then the rest
and
is
then
split.
Distribution.
Right, but we never did that. So again, looking at it as business, if you will, this has put a strain on particularly the fire department's budget to produce this revenue since that happened. And I can project forward, because we are only hiring paramedics, that as the non-paramedics retire, I know exactly what it's going to cost us for that additional going forward cost.
Should we be rethinking this?
What do other communities do? Are we atypical?
We'd have to do a survey, but there are communities that have a revolving fund and do it that way, and then there's some that don't. There's not a lot of communities.
I think some communities just keep it within the department.
Yeah.
They don't distribute it anyway.
With a revolving fund.
The question, what others do is interesting, but it's not really compelling. The question is, what should we do? It really is up to us.
Yeah, I mean.
Well, that is a really, that's a fair point for our discussion on the 24th, for sure.
I mean, I can tell you there was a dollar figure every year, going forward and backwards, that is an additional cost to Greg and his department because he offers this ambulance service.
So what's unfair to what the chief does when he's doing his budgeting is he can't, I mean, he can't capture.
He's subsidizing this activity.
That portion of what would be a profit center.
That's why you've got to recover.
That's just philosophically illogical.
Yeah. Philosophically, we've agreed to put the ambulance fee in his budget, right. The 4%. And that came in, if you will, off the top as an accommodating mm-hmm. cost. I could argue for some additional money that should go to his budget. I don't know what it is a year. It's not a huge amount of money.
Yeah.
But it might be $50,000, which is probably less, that should follow along every year to just keep up with the cost of running the ambulance, the marginal increase each year. And once we're fully staffed with paramedics, the yearly additional cost would be less. But right now, when we're hiring, again, from a non-paramedic, there's an additional cost.
Great. So, Bob, how does this square with your comment the other evening that we can't impose fees in addition to the costs they defray?
Say that again, Dan.
You said fees must be within the parameters of the costs they're actually defraying.
Right. And so
how are we allowed to run a surplus here?
We wouldn't have a surplus. If I were to cost out what an ambulance service costs, again, there's two pieces. One is the type of employee you need to hire. It's more expensive. And the other is how many employees did you hire that you wouldn't have otherwise needed if you didn't have an ambulance. So those are the two
it's
parts.
Still under
so
the capital and the wear and tear on the ambulances.
Yeah, fair point.
Yeah, the operations and sustainment, but not the capital cost.
Yeah, you can't do that, but it's a fair point to understand.
And one of the things that shouldn't get lost in the argument, the firefighters do dual duty. They're also, when we have a fire, they're fighting that fire.
Right.
And any other type of emergency, they end up just not sitting around waiting for an ambulance call. Yeah. They're doing other things.
Well, they're not waiting for an ambulance call or a fire. They're doing whatever's in front of them.
Absolutely.
Right.
John, I see this as an area that you've got to be. I see this as an area we've got to dig into deeper. I think there's some low-hanging fruit here.
This is why I said this has got to be. This piece of the discussion needs to be added to the long list on the 20th. Mark, you
list is getting longer.
Thank you. Mark Doxman. Chief, how does it work with who responds to a situation where you have a call? Is it always police and fire and ambulance? If so, why? Is that kind of law? Is that practice? How does that work? And the follow-up piece to that is, as we look at what our true costs are, isn't it really, you have an ambulance call, you also have fire and police responding, or across all three?
Yes. What we do when we have an ambulance call, we dispatch the ambulance. If our ambulance isn't available, it would be a mutual aid ambulance. And then we dispatch a piece of fire apparatus. It might be an engine, it might be a ladder truck. And the reason for the piece of fire apparatus is there's a lot of equipment that needs to get into that house. Needs to come back out, and that patient many, many times needs to be carried out. So you need a lot of people to carry that patient out. It's many times they're on the second floor.
Especially when you came and got me.
you need to physically carry these people down the stairs. So to do it with two people, you're just asking for trouble. And so the police do respond with us. That's part of the chief can answer that more specifically on that, but since we've gone to central dispatch, we also get a police officer as well. But the and a lot of times the fire engine or ladder truck is there before the ambulance, particularly the West Side District. They arrive first, treatment begins then. On the apparatus, we carry very much the same equipment that's carried on the ambulance. All the firefighters are medically trained. So treatment begins immediately. So.
I think the question is why are two or three departments involved in a call, and what drives that decision to send two or three pieces of equipment? Protocol, best practices, law?
Okay. From the police standpoint, a lot of times the police officers are roaming the roads, whereas the fire department's stationary. So we're sometimes, especially with a life and death situation, at the call They're all first responders. We carry AEDs in all the cars. And so a lot of times we're there prior to the fire department, you know, because we might be right around the corner. So if it's an accident or someone's, you know, going to the cardiac arrest, we could be right around the corner. So, you know, we're out in the road and about, whereas they're coming from a stationary point.
Correct. Yes. And they do help.
You don't want to have enough. You don't want to have not enough of them there on that given day.
Yeah. No, I'm not coming from the question of, geez, let's have less. I'm more thinking about what are our true costs here. I think they're a lot higher, again, than we think about.
Well, I think when we really dig deep,
more than just the
we're going to find out that there is. There are what I'll label as soft costs because we don't see them. Like, we're not writing a specific check directly to a specific cause. But the attendant costs are... This is one of the reasons I think that, you know, people get concerned about how government spends its money. Because it's very difficult to understand where it all goes. There are many pieces that, you know, pull on the roof, and it's not the way you run your house, you know. So it's difficult for people to understand.
I think it's more important to appreciate this service as a service to Reading than just as a way to, you know, fund our budget deficits.
Yes.
I mean, you know, we invested in that basically to have better services for our residents who pay the tax dollars for those ambulances and for those paramedics. So the fact that we're able to leverage that and have some offset of fees, I mean, we're not doing it just for the fees, we're doing it for the better service.
Right, and we've expanded our medical system out to the engine, to the ladder truck. So when they're staffed at paramedics, there's medications on those trucks that are readily available to those firefighters. No other community around us is doing that. So it's not unusual. You know, the ambulance is busy. It's at the hospital. If somebody has a cardiac event or we heard a lot about drug overdoses tonight, every truck we have carries Narcan and people who are trained to use it, and they're strategically placed to have quick response time. So nobody else around us has that level of service, and it's a great service for the community. We're all very, very proud of it.
Well, you should be. We didn't mean to derail you, but
no, it's okay.
That seems to be the order of the day tonight.
No, that's fine. I just kind of wanted to give you an idea with where the revenues came from, and if we increase revenue, this cost here will not change at all. Patients who are Medicare, that won't change. Mass Health, that won't change.
You're not going to get any more out of what they pay.
Correct.
Because they're not paying 100% of the bill today.
Correct.
And
they will only pay what they will pay.
And the trending up on self-pay is a result of them paying actually less. Mm,
correct. So that's kind of a behind the scenes kind of a thing.
Thank you, Chief.
Thanks.
Again, on your budget, just similar to the police department, it looks like you're having one less officer.
Correct.
And more overtime.
Correct.
You know, overtime for the fire department's always been sort of a challenge because if you have basic minimum levels of staff on a truck at any time. So do you anticipate more overtime on this with retirements? I mean, you always have, you know, there's injuries you can never predict, but
they do.
You know, again, is it dollar wise to cut a staff, to cut a sworn officer and replace it with overtime? I mean, it just seems the delta is, the savings is so small. It almost begs the question, why do that?
Right. The loss in the position will result in an increase in overtime. I can't tell you the exact amount, but it will result in an increase in the overtime. And we have another retirement coming in April. The loss of that position, I can tell you, will really raise the overtime. Because right now, we have, the fire department's organized around four groups of firefighters. And that will make one of the groups short. So every time somebody is on vacation or sick,
somebody's going to come from the other side.
That's right. So that, you know, we talked about the police and the stress, the same thing on the fire department. we don't order people in, but we don't let people go home. And so...
Take Christmas.
That's right. So...
Now you can't.
So that, and, you know, that's a morale issue.
You like take their shoes away?
We literally don't let them go home.
So I guess, Chief, are we spending more money by having one less officer? I mean, is that...
I can't...
Sounds unknown, right?
Yes.
But
it's unknown.
I mean, possibly yes, or possibly it's close?
Correct.
Yeah. The discussion we had that started almost a year ago, maybe last summer, because of the override discussion, was, again, the first firefighter, no one knows what the math is, but there's probably not a one-to-one correlation of what you save versus what it costs you. But a second one, there's probably worse than a one-to-one correlation.
Yes.
And a third one would be worse, and a fourth one.
It's exponential.
But that first one is not as difficult, if you will, to absorb as any additional. And that was the chief's argument for adding that, if you will, floater position. I've got equally staffed groups. As soon as one person is hurt or sick, I need to pay overtime.
Or retire.
Yeah, it's just like it's vacant. So that floater could then fill in for long term.
Is that the bottom of page 20?
We won't have that.
Bottom of page 27.
Is that 24, I think? The circle. Yep.
So, Greg, you really are not, you're not replacing somebody with what's going on.
Correct.
Okay?
Right.
Which is similar to what Chief Scully's done as well. So it's less about, you know, last guy in is the first guy out. It's more, we didn't bring the last guy in. So,
right. We had a captain retire, we made promotions, and we didn't fill that position.
Yeah.
There was some questions here. On questions 23 and 24, we did a restructuring of our command staff this year. We reduced the number of lieutenants by one and increased the captains by one. So we have five captains now and four lieutenants. And the additional captain is our fire prevention officer.
Yeah.
We did that for a number of reasons. One of them was flexibility. Right now I have a captain that's out due to surgery, so his group was without a captain. I reassigned the fire prevention officer to that spot. So we don't have a fire prevention officer anymore, but I plugged an overtime issue on that particular group. So making that promotion gave us some flexibility and helped us manage the department better.
Yeah. On 23, though, if I take the calendar year budget versus the projection, there's still a pretty healthy increase than the prior page.
On 23?
Look up on 23. Is that an extra?
Back.
Go back one page? Right there at the bottom. So you sum the 580K and the 390K and compare that to the sum of the two numbers just to the left of it. You're up by, what is that, 910 versus 970, so you're up by 60K?
Right. On, the captains will make a little bit more, and then we also have captains going through, two new captains going through steps.
I see.
So,
okay.
And then the lieutenants, four lieutenants. All our lieutenants have less than 1 year in grade.
So they're all
going
so
they're
to be
so they're increasing.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Also, on the firefighters, we have new firefighters, and we have six firefighters going through steps.
Okay, that all makes sense.
Got it. Yep.
And then the other. The town manager increased the radio repair budget. We all have portable radios. They're all about probably 5 years old now, 4 years old. All the batteries are dying, so they all need to be replaced. And we're also purchasing equipment. We've done a lot of joint training with the police department to respond to violent incidents, and we're buying protective equipment for the firefighters to be able to respond to those types of incidents.
Chief, same question I asked Chief Sagala. Is there anything from a technology point of view that you think in the future might help you with reducing the intensity of the stress that you know is better than we do? Heat cameras, I don't know, or body cameras.
We have thermal imager cameras. They're getting kind of old, so they'll need to be replaced at some point. They're becoming lighter.
Do you use them a lot?
They do get used a lot. Correct. Yeah, they get used on fire incidents, but they also get used when they're out investigating and unknown and in a house. It might be a heat condition behind the wall. They've got a smoke condition in the house. They think there's something going on behind the wall. They'll use that to get a look at it. And it's that gives them eyes when they go in to a fire because of zero visibility. We just put some technology on the fire trucks that will allow us to get hydrant locations. It's something that we've tried to do for the last 25 years or so.
So the little flags sticking up on don't work anymore?
No, they work to a point, but these they can see going into it better.
Yeah, okay.
And it gives us data on buildings, and we're going and I'm gathering that data. But, you know, it's the cost. It's hard for us to fund that within our expense budget. Our expense budget's very lean. And so that was a big leap for us to be able to do that. And the town manager made a presentation to the town manager, and he was able to help me out at the end of the year.
You're poking at the right thing. Because it's lean doesn't mean we shouldn't consider it. And it really comes to cost benefit. And that's really why I asked the question. Is there something out there in the next year or three that we should be looking at, like body cameras for the police? I'd be curious to get your comments later.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question. So I'm going to ask you the same question I asked you, Michelle. We know you're short one. How many are you really short one?
Well, we have two that are injured right now. And I expect to see one back in about 5 weeks, the second back in about 8 weeks.
But that could be a fairly chronic situation given the type of work we do, isn't it?
Yeah, it has been for us. You asked me a question is, what
so are you staffed properly is what I'm asking.
I would like to see us with four more assigned to the groups. So each group would be staffed at 12. Right now, each of the four groups is staffed at 11. What that would do for us is when everybody's there, it makes a much more efficient emergency operation. But it would also reduce our reliance on overtime. So we do have those injuries that would be hitting the overtime less, which results in less holdovers to be going in.
It would be very interesting to do, do a little cost study like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, an average year, and if you look back over 4 or 5 years, and I know you've got this information, what you spent in overtime for any number of reasons. Could be, could be retirement, could be vacation. I mean, it's all of those things that cause you to have to create overtime. It would be a very interesting study, and I'm not going to ask that you try to do it tonight, but I'd love to sit with you and just understand what we've spent and what the delta would be between having been staffed in a more appropriate way to the way you see it, compared with what we spend in actual dollars when we tie it out to overtime. And now it gets back to the thing that both you and Chief Scala mentioned, the stressors that it puts on to a stressful job anyway. It's hard to quantify what that's all about. It would be, you could do the first step, and I think it drives to the second step. It starts to tell you what we really shouldn't do.
Right. Yeah, and there's too much of a reliance on it. It's not good. It's not healthy.
So, Chief, if you had four new officers, really the true cost, if you just back out the overtime that you don't need, it might
right.
be two
it's
and a half.
It's about a third.
Three.
Yeah. It's not four.
No, it won't
sure.
be four.
It's not even, maybe. I would
correct.
Guess it's not close to four.
Multiply by about two thirds, I'd say.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, one more.
Mark Doctor again, sorry. Again, probably not for tonight. Can you look at what the impact is of having the West Side Station have two locations versus one just so and understand what that
would mean
for staffing and other things as well?
Well, I have. It does not cost the fire department any additional money to staff that. We need that additional engine company anyway. You can't have one engine company to fight a fire. one, our insurance rates would go would raise. But we need the two engines for operational reasons. The other thing is that when you look at the West Side District that it responds to, we've had a tremendous amount of development in the last 20 years, really. We've seen the Archstone project go in. We've seen schools.
Johnson Woods.
We've seen Joshua Eaton expand. That building's not fully sprinkled. We've seen Austin Prep expand. We've seen the Montessori School go in. We know another one's going in off of Summer Avenue. The Gazebo Circle project went in. We have four Summer Drive, four six-story buildings in there that three of them aren't sprinkled. So we have two churches that aren't sprinkled. And then we have an elderly housing complex that's not sprinkled, the multi-story buildings. So it's a district that, you know, I wouldn't want to take an engine out of because it's a longer response time. So if I took everybody and brought them down downtown, we'd have longer response times over there.
You couldn't fit the engines.
Well, that's another issue. So for us to take a piece of equipment out of service, we run two engines and a ladder truck for our fire suppression. There's not a lot of room to take something out and practically be able to respond.
Yeah.
But just to say it straightforwardly, you're staffed at the right headcount, whether it's divided into two buildings or in one building, it's still the same headcount.
Right, and the two buildings gives us a lot of flexibility on response and
response time. And it's the same equipment count, the same number of engines and support equipment. So the only real difference would be the operational, the heat and lighting of the second building. And that's all that really matters.
Which is not even a rounding error in a comparative way.
Chief, just to be clear, your four additional FTEs are from current staffing levels from FY17?
From what this budget asks.
What's your forecast?
Oh, so it's up five, up five actually, because you're dropping one.
I think it's up three from FY17.
Okay.
Correct. Yes.
Yeah, because it's the seventh.
We're losing one.
Yeah, we're losing one.
That's
right.
That's
why
I said four, because we're losing one under this.
Yes,
so just to be clear for the community, for the override discussion, we said that there would be one less firefighter or two more. Is the one less. For the police, we said one or two less. We were only needed to do one less or two more. And in both cases, the two more didn't necessarily fully staff those departments, but over time we would have. And it was a big step forward with these departments. I'd certainly agree with Greg that four from the proposed budget is a good number, five is better. It's probably not quite as bad as the police department in terms of the staffing, but it's difficult to know because, again, if you do a staffing study, they were offering an ALS service that's hard to find a comparison.
Well, it sounds like, the exercise with Greg is a little different than it would be with Mark because it tends to be an overtime exercise. So, end game is the same.
You're right.
So this has been very helpful. And I hope we haven't
The other thing too. One of the things that when we said with the override we would get two more or one less. What was never part of the override discussion in any of the listening groups or any the things that happened after is a presentation of the statistics that the chiefs have provided. Just the graphs of saying we did nothing more, it's a loss of service given all the additional activity that's going on. And
wouldn't you say, Barry, that we have there's a certain dynamic that's going on in the place we live. It's changing. And things that we accepted as a way to do business, even as short a time as 5 years ago, have changed dramatically in the way that we have to, especially around public safety. But tying them together is very important. I think that this continues to add agenda items to our bigger general discussion at the other end.
My one thing about the 17th after all.
I know that it's time for Gene, where are you? I'm sorry, but this selectman has to take 5 minutes. I don't know about anybody else.
Yeah, actually I do too. Do you want to just adjourn for 2 seconds?
Yeah, the big engine has to go take a
big engine.
Is it the higher?
Is he going up or
down?
He's going down.
So we were just talking about the Reading Diner, which I'd really much rather talk about than my budget, but for those of you who don't remember, how many people remember this, or Virginia, you don't count.
I was here at 4 or 5, she does.
So this was an actual diner on Main Street, where Biltmore, Maine is. Virginia, feel free to correct me if I get anything wrong. And it's kind of a fun picture that I've used a little bit just to show some of our character in the community.
Bring that back.
All right, so now moving on. Public Services Department is a little bit different than some of the others. We're a unique combination of staff, volunteers, boards, committees, commissions, and any other folks who want to get involved in some of the things that we do, and that could be any range of people. We have what I call 9, is actually technically 10 boards. The Planning Commission, the Zoning Board, the Conservation Commission, and I want to thank Anika Scanlon for joining us tonight. The Conservation Commission is actually meeting tonight, and she was nice enough to leave the meeting, leave her stuff on the thing, and come over here. So I may just jump right into conservation first so that she can go back to her meeting. Okay. The Historical Commission, and everyone knows the people in the room who are the Historical Commission, who do great work. The Historic District Commission, we also have them in the room. The Board of Health, and we have a representative tonight from the Board of Health in the room and the good work that they do. Council on Aging, the Recreation Committee, and the Fall Street Fair Committee. So that's a lot of nighttime government. I will say that we really do appreciate all the work of the volunteers and the important work of nighttime government. I'm going to get into it a little bit in terms of what it looks like, because we've talked a lot about it, and I think the Board of Selectmen is a little bit interested in understanding, you know, what it looks like from a little bit of a quantitative analysis. So I'll go into a little bit of that. But we really are committed to it, and we really are appreciative of the work that gets done there. This is the new organization of the department. So what's a little bit different here, and the boxes in yellow are the what's in FY18 budget as new positions. They're really not all that new. The recreation coordinator was here before and now it's back. The administrative specialist is a morphing of some turnover, comprised of the office manager, who's now half-time in this budget, and the fact that we lost our second assistant department head. So we kind of lost some positions and then we backfilled it. So what I like to describe this as is a more flat organization. There's still myself as the department head and Julie Mercier as the assistant department head and also the community development director. So I'm confident that there's enough backup for me. And then one of the other reasons this works is by bringing in an administrative specialist, we really feel like we're going to get a lot of help with a lot of nighttime government that we used to get from the community services director. And community services director was on the right-hand side of the org chart with the human services type divisions and overseeing that and going to a lot of the night meetings and shepherding a lot of programming and community events along. So that's why we see the yellow as the rec coordinator, to try and reinforce the capacity of what we're doing under recreation. And so the community services side are elder and human services, health, recreation, and veteran services, and then the staffing under that, nothing has really changed there in the blue. And then the green is the, those are the boards. And so you see how those fall into place.
So I understand, Jean.
Yep.
So Julie now is by herself in the middle, being a little schizophrenic, running in two directions. Is that essentially what's going on now?
Yeah, basically we're going to the model of one department head and one assistant department head. And we all kind of jump in. Obviously Julie spends a lot of her time on planning and building and conservation and historical, so the community development functions.
So she used to be on the left side.
She used to be on the left side. We kind of both on the everything side. And I think what makes this work is that the all of the administrators are very strong and have been here a fairly long time. So, like, I'll point to our Veterans Services Officer, Kevin Bowmiller, who is just so strong in veterans and so capable of running that, that, you know, he and I check in regularly, but he doesn't really need me. Yeah, it's better if I don't get involved for obvious reasons. And same with recreation. I mean, Jenna runs with it. She has her program. She does her programming. Yes, she needs a rec coordinator to help her do a lot of the work that she does. Same with health. We have a very strong health agent who's full-time. You know, we did this part-time, full-time thing for a while that got murky. And we have a public health nurse that's been on board for a while. And then we have a couple of public health inspectors that are part-time, but really give us a lot of bandwidth 5 days a week. So we're really well-staffed in that area. And then Elder and Human Services, I think this is the most staffed we've ever been. And Jane Burns does a great job. She's been here quite a number of years now. She's got her staff in place. As I said before, they're really well integrated into the community. The nurse advocate and the case manager do a lot of work behind the scenes that really delve into any number of areas with our human services and our senior population. And then the senior center coordinator has been here for a long time. The van driver's been here for a number of years. So I think the reason it works is because we just have a really strong team, and people have a very good idea of kind of where the high water mark is. So if they need to reach up to either Julie or me for direction, you know, we run it that way, and I think it runs pretty smooth. The other thing I wanted to mention is that we do meet regularly with all the administrators, so we meet monthly. So we don't just kind of wing it and kind of hope everything works out. We do have a monthly check-in where everybody gets around a table, all the administrators, and we go through what's going on. So I think that's pretty much it. The other thing I wanted to mention was the building division now is doing 5 days a week of inspections. So there's a building inspector, a plumbing inspector, and an electrical inspector. 5 days a week, we have Friday hours. Town Hall is closed, so you're wondering, how do you do that with Town Hall being closed? Well, we get creative, and we, as many of you know, lots of people are working on Friday in Town Hall. Mm. Don't get the word out too much, but we've come to the conclusion that it's better to schedule the capacity of inspectors that we have and stretch them out a little bit more into that Friday. It's just a couple of hours on Friday, but if somebody needs to pour a foundation, they're not held up because there's no inspector on Friday. We do ask that they schedule it on Thursday, so we're not like it's not like the fire department.
It's more
you can't dial 911 and you get us. You
so
know,
it's by appointment.
It's by appointment, yes. But that's I think, an important change to call out in this new org chart. The other thing I wanted to mention was that we used to have an administrative assistant up here in the top. She's now a permits coordinator, and that's the other glue that keeps this engine running. Mm-hmm. She's that's Kim. Kim is literally, I call her an expediter for anyone who's ever worked in a restaurant. Yeah. She's an expediter, and that's really what she does. She's emailing, texting, calling people on the phone, whatever needs to be done to get things going and keep things on track. And I'm really excited about that because I think that really makes the program work. And I also want to mention that all three of the part-time building inspectors that we have under the building inspecting and alternate building inspector, we have three part-timers here. And those building inspectors have all been in the lead top positions in other communities. They have decades of experience, and they work really well together. And so I think that's giving us, again, more depth, more backup if one's out, and more integration with just having enough hours out on the street. And you'll see the trending of where we are with permitting in the next few slides.
Oh, I was just about to ask that you have those numbers?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so this is what I was mentioning about kind of what we do with community events. And so I call this the nice to have slide. These are the events like the Fall Street Fair, and I won't go through the whole litany at this late hour, but there's a whole bunch of them. The ones I've highlighted in orange are the ones that we don't do anymore. So when you turn to me and you say, well, how are you staying within your budget? What are you not doing? I'm not doing the oranges. That's not to say those events aren't happening. They are. And that's not to say those events don't get some kind of benefit from daytime government. We help them if we can, but we're not going to the events, and we're not sending people to the events. The yellows
are... And you're not staffing the meetings.
We're not staffing the meetings. The yellows are under discussion. I'll call out the Fall Street Fair for starters. John Feudo, who was the community services director, spent an inordinate amount of time running the Fall Street Fair with a committee. He doesn't work here anymore. He took another job. So we are no longer owning that responsibility. We are very pleased that the committee's taking that on. Now, Jenna is involved in it, and she goes to the meetings. She's not taking the minutes. She's not running the meetings, and she's not running the Fall Street Fair. So that's another outcome of living within our budget. And on and on with a lot of these other items in yellow. How can we sit down when we have our monthly roundtable with the administrators? What can we do? How can we carve this up even more? Are we doing things, allocating resources the right way? And that's what we spend our time talking about. But I thought this was important so that everyone knew that we are really focused on the core responsibilities of what we do.
It seems kind of important that you start to look at the time. You know, there's certain that are overtime and some that don't apply and others that are comp. Every one of those is a cost item. Correct?
Yes. In one way or another. That's why we're taking out our carving knife and really figuring out the right combination.
Well, and these are community events. This isn't all of the committees that are involved that utilize professional staff in a nighttime environment.
No, that's coming.
Oh, that should be.
Yeah. Are we ready?
Jane, what's the meaning of the yellow? I know what they.
We're refocusing on that, on how we allocate resources there. Okay. Could we send less? Could we do something different? Could we manage it different? Do we need to do it? It's under the
radar.
Well,
in the Fall Street Fair area, you haven't even discussed public safety. That's just really community services.
Right.
Yeah, I think people don't realize sometimes the cost that nighttime government, one would think, is as inexpensive as turning on the lights. It's not even close to that.
You ready for the next one?
Please.
I'm frightened.
All right, get ready. Here we go. So this is the cost of nighttime government, just what public services does for nighttime government. And it's not including daytime hours, and it's not including all the other inputs, like town council.
Yep.
And I will tell you, on the zoning board, where you see JM and JD, that's Julie and Jean, the number that I would have to put there for town council would probably...
Blow the doors.
Yeah.
Up.
But this is just variable expense. You're not allocating any of the fixed expenses, the light, the building.
No. No, none of that's
No,
it.
This is just a first pass of, if I had to measure it, I can tell you the direct cost is almost $10,000 just to send people to as recording secretaries. That's my out-of-pocket.
And that's up here, buried here somewhere at 10K.
It's about 8,400 under direct costs.
Oh, I'm sorry, I see.
It's generally about 10,000.
Thank you.
But it's a little low on this slide.
And this isn't on average.
This is a real ballpark. I really didn't.
Well, I think you got to start someplace.
I mean,
we've never seen anything like this before.
No,
but we have asked for it. I mean, we ask you to consider it, and I'm really glad that you did.
So the for Julie, myself, and a recording secretary to be at the Planning Commission 21 times a year. We don't get paid. We don't get comp time. The recording secretary gets paid. But you can see what those numbers look like. And again, that does not include town council. And you can just go right down the list. Council on Aging meetings, Jane Burns doesn't get paid for. Board of Health meetings, again, it's just the recording secretary, and on and on.
So,
but,
Jean, when you say the indirect costs, but you're not going to, that's basically if you, we had to pay you, that's
if
what
you had
it would
to
cost?
Pay us an overtime cost.
That's what it would cost.
That's what it would cost.
So, and there's two ways to think about that cost. One of them is in real dollars. The other is in, you know, we hearken back to the discussion we had with both the chiefs. At a certain point, when you start piling on like this, the efficiency of the people involved has got to be impacted. I mean, you know, our volunteers, including all of us, do what we do all day, and then we volunteer our time at night. This is, you guys do what you do all day, and then your job continues into the night.
Right. And I'm not complaining about it.
No, I don't hear it as a complaint.
Julie and I talk about it all the time. We want to go to these meetings.
Well, it,
we need to be at these
If you're
meetings.
Not at the meeting, then you're not going to be able to do your job efficiently in the day. And
right.
I get that.
Right.
But, you know, there is a cost to doing business here. And it does somehow, I mean, when you stop to think about the amount of committees that are functional in the town, some of them have to continue to be exactly what they are for a variety of reasons, some of them based on the charter. Others, it makes you wonder, you know, when they're related committees, is there some economies of scale that would slow down the human factor of stress on our employees and manage our costs a little bit better? It's certainly something that I think we're going to have to talk about. Yes, Bob?
Also, as the person responsible for forcing these I should be very clear that the column that says indirect costs, personnel policies and labor law is pushing that in the direction of paying them. There's been a lot of conscripted labor, quite honestly, by employers for a long time.
Yep.
This town government is no worse or no better than most. But our ability to not pay people to do these things is ending, right, legally.
Well, I mean, witness the, you know, the legislation that got pushed off a little bit that was scheduled for year end relative to the level that somebody's paid. Nonprofits around the country are, they don't know how they're gonna stay in business.
Exactly. We're facing
for
the
those
same
exact
kind of
reasons.
Even if staff were willing to volunteer their time, they may not be legally allowed to.
Correct.
I think the problem is the word cost, John. Cost, people think of a dollar sign. This is the burden of nighttime governance. And it's expressed in unpaid, conscripted hours and, you know, directed costs. But it's the total burden of nighttime government.
And really, what's not accurate here is that the amount of time that we spend during the day on nighttime government, this is just going to the meeting and being sitting in a chair.
Right.
So getting ready for the meeting, doing all the follow-up after the meeting, that's not shown here.
Well, I think that if nothing else, I'll be right to you in a second, Barry. I think if nothing else, one of the things that as a Board of Selectmen we have talked over the last several years, and I think we need to take action on gathering the boards and committees elected, and not necessarily, I mean, we're elected, we would certainly speak to the other elected boards, but those that are advisory to us, I think that we've got to have some discussion and interaction with each other at a higher level than we've been doing so that we become more efficient. And so I think to that end, we're going to have to start to think about bringing a representative, hopefully the chair or the vice chair or both, together into some training workshops. For several reasons. One is so that we can improve the efficiency by cross-ruffing what we're each doing. The second piece of that is to help volunteers understand how to efficiently use the staff time that's given to them and don't overuse it, because I have a suspicion that both of those things are probably not on the beam the way that they should be. So, yes, Bob.
In the economic development project, I'm going to some of our peer communities, and one of the striking things that I've learned that I didn't expect to learn is, for instance, the economic development committees in other towns are, when I say independent, I mean 100% independent. They take care of themselves. One that I went to this week had 9 members and 3 alternates. 3 of the members are chairman of the Board of Selectmen, town manager, and effectively Gene's position. Those 3, forgetting the chairman of the Selectmen, those 2 employees come to meetings and do nothing else. They do not organize the meeting, they do not do minutes, they do not post the meetings, they do not set the agenda, they attend as a resource. And otherwise, the committee is totally functionally on their own. That is much more commonly what I'm finding a model to be. Redding has always been very hands-on with employees. I don't know, there's pluses and minuses to each. There's the minus. The plus is much better flow of information, committees that have an ability with a staff person there to be better informed of what the big picture is. Sure. So there's pluses and minuses, but this is a cost that other towns seem to manage to avoid.
I do think that this is, we've been talking for the last several days about topics that need to come up in general discussion among ourselves to try to find more efficient ways to get things done and to more efficiently use the available resources and dollars that we have. And so,
yeah, if you think about just the last year for your board, I don't know the data, but you've had more joint meetings than any of the Board of Selectmen ever, I'm sure. Between the Farm Building Committee, Bylaw Committee, CPDC, on and on. And
well,
those
we're hoping
meetings
to be
are
interactive.
Well, and those meetings are generally, I think, very effective. More so than, you know, just as a meeting would normally be.
Well, we witnessed that on
Monday
this week with the CPDC.
That's worth 2 or 3 meetings.
Yeah. This is, I think, the second or third time we've met together.
Right.
And the end result is very positive.
It's very efficient.
It's very fast. I guess it's very fast to get to a conclusion.
Yeah. So that's another model, is maybe these boards meet by themselves less often.
Yeah. 2 or 3 years ago, to accomplish what we accomplished last Monday night would have taken 6 months. and it actually took about 6 weeks.
Yeah.
So, Gary, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, I guess I'm having a hard time just the way the conversation's getting framed, you know, with the definition of daytime versus nighttime government. For better or for worse, the way we've organized it, that's our government. All right, that's how we've decided to be. We decided to have boards and commissions that are staffed by volunteers. The meetings have to be at night unless you want to have 100% of your boards and committees staffed by retirees. So that's just the government that we chose. So it's great that we're sort of saying, hey, there's some cost to this, and I have no problem putting in the budget, whether it be, you know, $40,000 or $50,000, to pay for staff time to go to the meetings. But the whole daytime versus nighttime government, I just think it just sets up a whole kind of,
I don't think this is a wrong tone.
I don't think this is
a daytime versus nighttime discussion at all.
Yeah, no, it's like, this is our government. Our government, we have very competent staff people, we have elected boards, and we have 9 or at least committees under Gene's purview that do the basic work of government, and most of those meetings, unfortunately, are at night.
I think the issue is different, though. At daytime is paid by salary and wages.
Right.
Nighttime is conscription. That's the 31K.
Right. So, you know, we recognize the cost, and we say, okay, it costs us to do this government that we've chosen to do under the charter that we have, and we put it in the budget. I mean, could we meet certain boards like the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Commission, you know, joint meetings to more efficient and get decisions done? Absolutely. But the whole
trend
of this.
This isn't a day versus night. This is
a discussion about the reality of
what's going on. Once you identify the reality of what's going on, then possibly you can look for more efficient ways to get it done. That's all that is. This is not about saying, oh my God, you know, the people that are paid staff are not going to support anybody anymore. It's not that at all. It's a discussion about the realization of some of the inefficiencies as they exist.
Right.
And if we're going to look at all the dollars, we have to look at all the dollars, and it's not as simple as saying you could put $50,000 more in the budget, because if that was true, we wouldn't be not hiring police and fire. It's not that simple.
But this also dovetails with our idea of better customer service, in that we would rather have people use daytime government for their permitting, have to spend less time with nighttime. The whole issue over accessory apartments spoke to that. We try to move that into daytime. Hopefully fewer meetings necessary by nighttime. Just repurposing some of the things to solve multiple objectives.
We're also in some sense subsidizing nighttime government, or I should say the employees are. And when you subsidize it, you encourage the growth of it. If this was, we might do exactly the same thing, even if it had real cost attached to it. We also might say, you know what, let's do something different. This is too expensive. Right now, those costs are hidden. We're not motivated to ask those questions.
Again, my point is, by charter, this is the government that we have. And you know, if you want to make it more efficient and have our employees handle these during the days, and you know, obviously it's going to look a whole lot different. So again, I guess my problem is the whole term of daytime and nighttime government.
I disagree.
We have a government, and this is how we've chosen to organize.
You're falling into a problem of free cash. No one likes the term free cash because it's not free. You're falling into a term problem. You just don't like the sound of it.
Yeah, I mean, that's, but again, it's sort of...
A way to describe what the two differences are.
It's really not combative. Yeah. You know, I mean, it's a discussion is all it is. It's a discussion about efficiency. Yes, Mark?
So I agree right to that statement. It's not just a discussion about efficiency. It's a discussion about how do we best get the community input and run the government that we have. We see that there are costs we haven't identified. It's good we've identified them. But it's not just about how do we make it more efficient? How do we have only joint meetings? How do we have fewer meetings? Could be that those are some of the good answers. Could also be that this is exactly how we get a lot of stuff done, and we're just not recognizing it.
It's a process to get to an answer. So yes, I don't disagree that there's only one answer. I say that this kind of analysis stimulates the discussion that's necessary given the financial environment that this town finds itself in. So, you know, back to the reoccurring theme of no stone unturned, this is part of that going on.
F1G, where are you going next?
And, well, I just want to say, I probably shouldn't say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. In those teeny-weeny little letters where it says vacant, there's conservation and there's Fall Street Fair. We do not have a recording secretary for either of those boards. And I won't bore you with the details of how we get it done, but I will just say, volunteers get it done. Staff, daytime staff helps out. It's not a great model, and...
They get to run around with scissors.
And Nika can speak to it.
Can I just comment, and let me preface this by just saying, I think my comment is, this brought up a discussion at one of our meetings, and I don't know if anybody saw that video. It's prompted a discussion at one of our meetings. How are we as a volunteer board going to get this done? Is Chuck going to do it? Are we going to assign somebody for that night? How are we going to do this? And it actually started an interesting discussion, and we didn't have our town clerk available to help guide us through this question and answer process. But one thing we were actually discussed was, is there some way, since most of these meetings are videoed, some way that instead of a series of meeting minutes being drawn up and drafted, is there some way we could have video recording of the minutes? You know, is there something that can take some technological advancement?
It's the video
not under current state law.
That can legally, legitimately,
or someone can do the minutes by looking at the video.
I mean, I don't know. I just asked that question. It was something we talked about, something
good
we
question.
Talked about.
It is a great question.
It is a great question.
Yes.
Is it possible to have an open meeting law compliant session without a recording secretary?
Yeah.
The volunteers do it.
But you need a secretary.
So if you had a YouTube live,
well, minutes don't.
They have one. We just don't have
it. Minutes do not have to be stenographic. They just have to record the important actions taken, the attendees.
We're getting it done and it's okay. But it's kind of not fair to the Conservation Commission that that they don't have somebody, all these other boards have someone going and doing it,
point taken.
They don't have to worry about it. It may be that when we go back to, and I haven't quite figured it out, but this administrative specialist, I have her pointed to planning and building, but it may be that bringing that over to conservation so that that person can go to the meetings and take the minutes and, you know, scheduling that time of this new person may solve that. Or
are all these meetings recorded by RCTV, if not live, then by?
Many.
Not necessarily.
And that could be one of the issues because, you know, to your point, Anika, I mean, when I was young and working for a corporation right out of college, when the dinosaurs were roaming the earth,
there was a pool of people
that took care of correspondence. Okay, now it makes you wonder if you did have a video library, if we found ourselves over time working closely with RCTV to be able to create a video library every time this goes on, and you had a specialist that was very adept at, you know, literally, you know, having half their day possibly
watching
the videos and taking the minutes. I mean, it does beg a certain question regarding the conscription idea. I mean, you know.
There is also speed. I mean, I don't want to replace, you know, valuable staff. I think there are certain parts of the meeting that need to be noticed, and I don't know what the purpose of the minutes would be after the fact, whether, you know, certain people who go in say, well, now we have a real lawsuit issue with that permit. We need more specifics. Honestly, we would probably go back to the video anyway, as opposed to the transcript.
If we had such a video.
Speech recognition software, you know, that could listen.
Yeah.
I mean, there's got to be some, you know, so we brought it up. We had that discussion because we were in the pickle. We were thinking, what, is there another way to do this?
Yeah.
How are we going to do this? How is this going to get
done? These kinds of discussions spawn solutions. I mean, they're not designed to be, you know, to put somebody in a challenging spot. It's designed to challenge them to think, you know, collectively and collaboratively for, you know, an idea like that. I think that's a great idea.
Would a transcript satisfy his minutes?
No.
No?
No, it wouldn't even have to be that detailed.
No, he said it wouldn't satisfy.
Yes,
but
right now under Mass state law, minutes must have certain things.
Yeah.
A word transcript of the meeting per se does not exactly match the state law. You need to highlight and make sure everyone can see votes, for instance, as opposed to just a bunch of words saying, whatever. You have to actually make that really clear in the minutes. Okay. And that's why you usually see them bold and underlined. You know, Paula has on occasion watched a tape after the fact in order to either improve or do minutes.
Clarify.
So that is absolutely possible.
Right. Yeah.
But I
you get all this
can't
do
that.
No. No, it's not a robot thing.
There is technology available, and believe me, I get solicited all the time to buy it, to help us take an RCTV tape and index it and link it to our website so that you go into an agenda, click on the agenda, and it goes right to that spot in the meeting.
That'd be tough to do in our meetings.
But that's
you got that right.
it's not as you guess. It's not
they could invent a whole set of software on the bus.
Far from limited.
I don't think software can handle you.
It's called Three Stooges stuff.
All right, so moving on.
It's getting late, folks.
Yep.
So this is just a few bullets about kind of my take on this leaner, flatter public services. Fewer resources for the nice to have. REC more focused on programs. Sharper focus on where the resources go. That's the oranges and the reds. We're also proposing closing this building, the Pleasant Street Center, at 3:00. So closing an hour early. The staff would stay and catch up. And for all those staff that we send to those oranges and reds, well, not the oranges, but the yellows. They can use that hour to take comp time because the center will be closed. Reduced participation in community events. and then the building staff, as I mentioned, Monday through Friday. We do have less counter hours through the week to make that happen, including the Tuesday nights. We no longer offer that. This is just a summary of activity under buildings and inspection. I'll go through this kind of quick because it's not the most exciting, but just to give you a snapshot of where we're at, this gives you a little bit better idea of where we are with permits. We do about 1,000 building permits a year, which always is very shocking to me that that number is as high as it is.
What was the spike in 15 and 16?
I think those were the big project years, Redding Woods Johnson Woods and that kind of thing. We're really spiking on the inspections, as you can see. And so when we get to, I'll talk a little bit about fees, and I know we could have a whole night just to talk about fees, but there may be some opportunities to get at that inspection spike with some ideas on fees.
Have we done peer assessments of fees?
We have, yep.
Where do you think we are?
We've done it about 5 times in this last 7 years.
Where do you think we are?
I think we're low, and I think that we're low in places where it's probably not going to amount to a lot of money. Our plumbing and gas and our electrical fees are low, but we only generate. I'll go back. The wiring fees collected for 2016 were $80,000. So if we bump that, I don't know. Could we get another 10,000 maybe?
Your point is, this is off a small base. The real question is, you think we're 10% low, 20% low, 50% low? Any idea?
Well, it's kind of hard to quantify it that way. We're off a little bit, and we could probably adjust it
okay. And
generate a little bit more money. The building permit is the biggie, and I'll show you a little bit more of that on a future slide. We're not really that low on the actual
per thousand.
Yeah, 11 per thousand and 12 per thousand is pretty comparable to our peer communities.
So there's no law that says we have to be
no.
At.
No.
How does
we're not. We're
how
not.
Does that tie to our costs? 11 and 12 per thousand. Is it the cost of the truck roll to get the guy out there? Is that the thought?
It's kind of the going rate.
I mean, where's the cost calculation there?
Right here.
Okay.
I'm just going to keep going because I know it's so late. So the other thing I wanted to say about building that isn't shown here in the numbers is the turnaround time for permits. So when I first started working here, I was at a Board of Selectmen meeting, not this board, and very much criticized for lack of customer service and lack of ability to be responsive to the public. So I took that very seriously.
You had been here for a week, so
so it was your fault. Yeah.
But it is that sort of that impression that people generally have that government works too slow, and in some cases that's probably true. But I wanted to tell everyone about what's happening with our permitting. So almost half of the permits that we issue, I'm talking about building permits now, are issued the same day. So that's a pretty significant amount of permits that are being pumped out. If you add into that applications that need a couple more things or somebody doesn't have something lined up quite yet, that goes up to about 76% of the building permits are issued only in a matter of maybe a couple of days if you add those others in. So I thought that was pretty significant. And one of the main reasons for that is that the permits coordinator is empowered, and this goes back to why this model works, empowering people to be able to make decisions and do things. She can issue windows, siding, roofing, bathroom remodel, kitchen renovations, provided that they have the licenses, the insurances, there's no structural issues, there's no conservation, there's no planning issue, there's no engineering issue. So we've come up with a way to do this that we can have staff, not necessarily the building inspector, issue permits and move projects along.
So, Jean, can I ask a question on those type of permits and kind of the fees that get charged? So let's say I come in there and I'm just doing a bathroom remodel and, you know, a couple other things. So I come in, I give you my I give you my scope of work, and you say, okay, you ask me, how much are you going to spend? And I say, I think I'll spend $20,000. Someone look at that and say, that's not a $20,000 job, that's an $80,000 job. And I'm charging you 80 times 11, you know, 11 as opposed to 20.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah.
Is there, so, I mean, not only is it the mill rate,
right,
but it's also kind of, you know, the fee is based on the estimated
the cost
of work. Now, if you're doing a big thing, you come in with a construction contract. That's easy to kind of figure out.
Yeah.
But if it's something that's sort of not that detailed, I mean, are we applying kind of common sense to these things and saying, wait a minute, that's not... You know, that's not a $20,000 job.
Yeah, the building inspector, Glenn Redmond, has been in this job for almost 20 years. And he knows construction. He worked in construction. That's his background. And he's the one that issues the permits. He's the one that verifies the amounts when we get to anything of any substance. So if something looks off, they'll put a hold on it and say, I want to double check with Glenn that this is right. So we have a check system, and I think we have a pretty good amount of expertise looking at that.
So you think, are we getting zoomed in terms of, you know?
Well, the bigger question is how many people don't even bother pulling a permit.
Oh, that's
right.
Chickens will come home to roost on those when they sell their house.
Well, when you look at the graph, you can, the graph kind of tells a little bit on the permits pulled.
Right.
Looks significantly lower than what the economy has done around it.
Right. Moving on to planning, I'll just quickly say that obviously we've had a busy year and a lot of zoning, and with Julie on board, we're doing things a lot more efficiently. We're reducing our consumption of paper. She's leading the charge on resource management, which has been great, and her expertise in planning and design is really come up with solutions that design teams themselves don't even come up with. We don't charge for that. Bob said we have to stop doing that.
For free.
The subsidized housing inventory, I know we talked about this recently. We're getting close. If everything goes the right way, we think we should be in a position to apply for what's called a certification from the state, which means a temporary hold on 40Bs. The 40Bs have really made it challenging as far as resource management and staff time. So we're hoping that we can get that done. Historic, this is all volunteers. Shout out to the historic volunteers in the room. They do a lot of work, and you know, we have just a minimal amount of daytime staff that help them out and do small things for them. But they really run it, and they do a lot of good things. Conservation, with Anika still in the room, and then I'll let her go running out. The meeting's over. That's bad when we go longer than conservation. Really, the story with conservation, and you'll see some of the graphics with Chuck there, and with the leadership of the commission, everybody's working together to solve problems. And the intangible story that really speaks to kind of how this works is an elderly, recently widowed applicant was planning to move into her son's house after an in-law addition was built. But it was December and the site had conservation issues. So she's fighting with the winter conditions and worrying about her plans. And she calls conservation, and so Chuck goes out and does the actual wetland delineation himself to see if the project was viable, to understand if this can be expedited. And through a lot of work, he figured out a way to do this and in a quick way, and came up with a quick solution. And then within 6 weeks, the construction started and was finished before the spring, allowing her to move in with her family. So everybody really is trying hard to do the right thing, do the job, but to get people what they need and to provide that customer service.
To capture those little vignettes, I think they're important to
store
away somewhere.
I mean, it's hard to see numbers and graphs and understand what it is that we really do, because it's a little bit different. This is just a snapshot of the permit activity, and you can see the minor project permits are way up. And that, again, it makes it a lot easier on the applicant. This is our fee picture, and you can see that fees are up. When I talked to Chuck about this to try and understand it a little bit better, there's been a little bit of a change to the regulations that allows applicants to pay if they have to locate a pool that's maybe not in the greatest location, maybe a little bit closer to the wetland area. And so that's largely, that combined with a couple of other larger projects accounts for why the fees are up a bit. Okay, moving on to Human and Elder Services. You know, the Pleasant Street Center is really the heart of what we do, 40 programs, the lunch program, a couple of new programs that are going, the Memory Cafe. If anyone hasn't heard about it, you should check it out. It's a great program. It's dealing with people who have memory loss, and it's doing some very innovative things. Again, just pointing to what we're doing with public safety, I think that's really important work, and providing that link that's very much needed that we talked about earlier. And also the property tax worker program, that's at a max. So we're very excited that we have that as a resource too. And I'll show you some stats so you'll understand kind of what the activity looks like.
So will that be, that property tax worker program, tell me how that works.
So this is where you get a break on your taxes if you essentially volunteer your time for the town.
Ah, okay.
You have to meet the criteria, and it's limited to a certain number. But so we get people to do mailings, and they're doing, you know, if we have a big mailing, we can get the property tax workers. Jane's very creative about making sure that they're, you know, doing important work.
Will those people be able to help with our new application process?
Well, that's
for our
good idea.
Relief?
I don't think so.
No?
No. There's issues of confidentiality.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Well, I mean, how much more confidential could it be than their income tax return?
Exactly.
I mean.
And these property tax workers, just to be clear, are paid for by the assessor's overlay, the forgiveness of the tax.
I see.
But they're not necessarily preparing tax returns.
Oh, I see. They're doing all kinds of things.
They're doing all kinds of things.
I see. They could be down at the
compost
center,
yep,
for example.
Yep.
Right. Okay. I misunderstood that.
I also want to mention that we are doing a master plan for Human and Elder Services. And we had a little bit of leftover end of the year money that we put to use and hired UMass. So we're going to be meeting with them starting next week. And this will really give us a good projection. We know that the tide is coming. It's actually already here. And it'll give us an opportunity to really think about what should we be planning for the future, for that baby boomers like me who are graying. I'm graying right now, actually.
You're a pretty young baby boomer. Let's watch what club you're driving.
And on this one, the intangible story, a resident that had a stroke 6 years ago and developed dementia with declining health. At the time the resident was referred, the couple had no support in place, and the spouse was providing the care, rarely left the house, really, in months, relying on the neighbors to do errands and groceries. And this was a young senior couple in their 60s, early 70s. When the case manager visited the couple, bringing them a meal, she also introduced the nurse advocate, and they both together started to realize that this couple really needed some help. What's important to note here is that they did not qualify for Mystic Valley Elder Services. And so it's hard to remember that Mystic Valley Elder Services is a great resource, but you have to be income eligible. It's a really low number. So if you're in the middle, you don't qualify for Mystic Valley, which is where they found themselves. And so the case manager and the nurse advocate worked with the couple to arrange for hospice and care in the home. And one spouse remains homebound with proper care. The other spouse is able to take care of family business and get on with what they he or she needs to do. And then the point is that there have been 43 client visits since April. And so if the numbers don't show what we're doing, the intensity of the work that we're doing is shown in this little example.
Gina, have we considered, maybe this doesn't work, but I know in Wakefield where I attend, it is. Some of the local congregations and churches have what's called a meals ministry for elderly. And it's not members of the congregation, it's anyone who needs. They can walk in, they'll often have a food pantry, they may even have a clothing closet. Maybe you can't do this because it's volunteer and you can't manage it, but have we thought about contacting the congregations and seeing if there's any, just around the food part of it, not about the care and any of that other stuff?
But they do.
Yeah.
I have firsthand.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
I think all of those resources quietly work together.
Already. It's already happening. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it's like the food pantry. I mean, that's every week that thing is stocking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a lot going on that people probably
don't realize. Yep. So this graph shows you that the biggie is the van rides. Transportation is really huge and ever growing. The meals is also another item that's upticked. Fitness programs and then recreation as well.
What is the ordinate there? The y-axis, is that dollars, trips?
That's, I think that's, down.
Visits are the amount of.
This is our number.
Amount of visit. 6,000.
Like the number of.
6,000 van rides?
Yes,
oh,
over
people.
The course of the year. That would be,
oh my
the van
goodness.
Operates 5 days a week, multiple trips
oh
during
my goodness.
The day. And oftentimes the van driver, at the one point, he'll be bringing folks over to Market Basket or Stop and Shop, drop them off, go loop around, pick folks up, bring them here for a little, drop them off, go back to Stop and Shop. So the van runs continually Monday through Friday from about 8 o'clock in the morning till 3:30 in the afternoon.
So you've done 4,000 fitness programs in 2016?
Yes.
Or is that 4,000 people 4, that are
people.
Assisted? I
yeah,
see.
Yeah, not 4,000.
Okay.
4,000 people.
Sorry, I got it.
We run fitness 5 days a week.
The demand is huge, isn't it, Jim?
Yes.
It's just...
These numbers
again,
are much bigger than
I
would have guessed.
This kind of information we're getting is really powerful. It tells you a lot about...
Look at the meals. 5,000 meals.
Of
course.
The wonderful thing is it's an active center. It's, you know, we made a great effort this year of upgrading a lot of our entertainment, bringing in some new programming, partnering with other organizations to bring events and services into the center, which has made it active. Our special lunches, we're starting to, for big ones like St. Patrick's Day, we'll sell out. We're permitted for 70 people, and for St. Patrick's Day, we will have 70 people.
When you say sell out, you do not mean revenue drivers.
No.
Just want to be clear.
We sell out in terms of space.
Yes.
So we will have 70 people in here for St. Patrick's Day or for Chinese New Year or a barbecue in the summer. And we will be at capacity and run a waiting list for some of the evening events.
This slide shows overall contacts, and this is, again, going back to the nurse advocate. It spikes up in FY16 because in FY15, it was a vacancy, so it's back up because of that. And the contacts dropping off on the blue graphic up here, that's really a result, again, going back to that story where we're doing more intensive work, maybe not... It might not be the same number every year, but we're doing really intensive repeat work. So it's not like we're doing less, really. I'm going to switch gears now to health and the work that's done there, which is really the food establishments alone doing 221 routine food establishment inspections, 7 new food establishments that came in, 71 complaints, 985 flu vaccines, and 22 flu clinics. the intangible story here that I wanted to share was about our health agent working closely with property owners and establishments to improve management of trash areas. And he provided a fact sheet and really did education on rodent prevention. And we've really seen a marked improvement in trash management, and we're very pleased with that because that can be a real issue. Moving on to recreation, again, all the programming, the 450 programs, field scheduling, employing the seasonal staff, and as I think most people know, you know, rec has a rec revolving fund, and so the expenses come out of that rec revolving fund, so you don't really see that in this budget. And in fact, rec usually turns money back every year.
How much do you roughly?
80, 100,000. Maybe a little more because they raised their fees.
You know, when you think about that in terms of, you know, how it funds itself, it becomes more incumbent on the capital discussion we had last night. Because you've got to have the space and the facilities, these programs to roll. And, you know, it concerns me to a certain extent when we looked last night at the capital plan and how recreation has just been pushed out a decade in some cases on some of these things. And then you look up here and you see how used it is and how it never comes out of the budget. It funds itself.
And the intangible story here is really about the scholarships that rec offers. Obviously, people that fall into hard times, that is a huge benefit that, again, like with the food pantry, no one would really know about that, and it just quietly gets done. So this just shows you kind of the steady number of registrations, activities, and then revenue. Last but certainly not least is veterans. And with Kevin Bowmiller at the helm, as I said before, we're in great shape with veterans. These benefits, the Chapter 115 benefits, are being run carefully, monitored. We're making sure that those that are getting the benefit are qualified. Kevin's had to do the unenviable task of, you know, saying no to people when they don't qualify anymore, and that's difficult, but it's the right thing to do. You know, there's also been an increase in presence in the community, and when I go back to the chart and think about, you know, what can we slice and dice for community events, I feel really bad because this this story talks about how when at the Fall Street Fair, the veteran services officer met an elderly veteran and his daughter, and then encouraged him to come to town hall. Again, being in the community and reaching out to people has a tremendous benefit. When they came in, Kevin realized that because the veteran's wife passed away, the veteran was losing out on the pension, and they did not sign up for the survivor benefits option. The veteran still lives in his own home and has medical issues and costs associated with that. His only income is $1,700 for Social Security, and they wondered what else could they do, and that's exactly what the Chapter 115 program is there for. Kevin got him enrolled, got him what he needed for help, some other assistance, and this family couldn't be happier to have that resource and never really would have realized it if it wasn't for that connection. So that's why we're in the community as much as we are. So I'm just going to spend another couple of quick minutes talking about fees and permits, and again, I could go on and on about this, and I won't. But this just gives you a snapshot of what we did in 2016 for building permits by type, and what it looks like, and how many, and what the fees are. And I highlighted in yellow what I thought was the big ticket item, which is the interior alterations. That could be any number of things, taking a wall down or whatever. But you can see that there were 327 permits issued for interior alterations. That's a lot of permits. And so, you know, what does it mean? It means that we're really busy, and it means that even if our it looks like on paper that, you know, we don't have Tuesday hours anymore, or, you know, we're tweaking it here and there, we're pushing out a lot of permits, and that's the point I wanted to make on this slide.
Is there a way to combine any of those, Gene? This may be a stupid idea, but is there a way to have two or threes that are generally related, but you could say in this case it's not there, and simplify it? The paperwork gets smaller. If he's got two of these, you deal with them as one. Is that possible?
This is the way we're collecting the data. So if somebody comes in for an application to put a new roof on, they're using the same application. This is the way our software program collects it and sorts it.
Yeah, it just sorts out what they're actually applying for, right?
Yeah.
It's all the same.
It's all the same application.
So when $40 million worth of projects go on, how much of that do you think actually is recovered in assessed value?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. Hopefully all of
it. Well, you would think.
The assessors get all this data.
Yeah, it's all integrated.
Yeah, electronic.
Yeah, but not every dollar you spend on a renovation adds the value, though.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why I'm just kind of wondering. I mean, you know, if you added $40 million of value, which you wouldn't, I think you're right.
Yeah.
Well, all the new construction in the middle there, you'd hope would be, right?
Well, you'd hope it'd actually be more.
Be more, because you've got the land.
Be more.
Yeah, but that comes assessment's in, not.
Although the land is already, you know, on the rolls.
Assessment's not based on fair market value.
Right. No, but when you're putting $40 million into your home, I mean, into your collective home, you know, ready, some amount of that ought to be new revenue, wouldn't you think?
It is. It's new growth.
New growth.
But I couldn't tell you how much exactly.
Is that formulaic in the way these roll into the assessor's databases, or is there a judgment phase where they say yes, no, yes, no?
Yeah.
COs and permits.
This is what the electrical permits look like, the fees, the number of permits. And again, the big ticket item here are the additions and renovations that generate these electrical permits. And then this is gas and plumbing. So this is just a snapshot of the kind of work. We have tons of data in the file, and probably a lot of it needs to be updated. But I pulled out what I could just to give you one small snapshot of where we are. And this is pretty current with our gas and plumbing fees. So the first column shows you the current fee. This is where we're at right now. And they're almost every one of them is so much lower than what the average is. And this average rate, it's a rate that we collected data for about 9 communities. We didn't always get the 9. Some maybe only have 7.
What's your judgment of what the average would be?
It's a rough average.
We're way off.
But you can see. And then I just guessed on recommendations. It's nothing more than a guess.
Like, does town meeting set those, or does the board select?
We do.
I think they use.
Yeah, we've got to look at this.
No, we do.
This is, that is material.
Right.
Because now when you interface that into all that permitting,
yeah,
and, you know, and $484,000 worth of fees, that you're essentially saying you can increase by 25% to 40%?
Well, the real city, you know, is that we don't do it every year, because how many is an opportunity cost of not having looked at this in 2012 and 2000?
Well, you're right, because you missed them all.
Right. So the other thought is you almost need a review annually that says it goes up by 2.9%.
Maybe that's something we need to put
and
on
this
our...
Is, you know, and this is unlike, you know, a business deciding how to set a price. It's not like people are going to say, well, your building permit fee went up $2 a thousand, I'm going to go to Wakefield.
Exactly.
I mean, it's if we're not charging,
and it isn't
what
even
the
about
market,
price gouging. It's about
it's what the market will bear. It's, if we're not doing that, then
how is
know.
This how is this different than the other fees, which are cost?
It's all the same. It's
well,
all
so
the cost base.
Yeah, I mean, if the average rate is $50, and we're gonna double our rate, but it's still $5 less. I mean, in that case, it's still 10% less.
John, if we move, it'll move the average anyway, so we'll still be below. So,
Gene, are our fees covering cost right now?
I was just going to say, you have to justify any fee change with cost, and we probably can. I mean, in math, you can do anything.
Sure.
But it is possible that we do something so much more efficiently that we can't justify.
figures don't lie, the liars.
So a lot of our inspectors are half-time.
Here's the final word.
But are we actually covering costs right now?
That's why I say this is just a rough snapshot.
No, but this bears discussion.
This whole discussion on fees.
Because just in the building.
Because that's a department that should cover its costs.
Right. But we just opened on Saturday or Friday.
Yeah. And this is a department that absolutely should be covering its costs. We should not be bleeding out of the building.
More hours than one person would have.
Right. We used to have full-time people doing this. Now a lot of them are half-time. So.
But there are three half-times instead of one full-time.
Yeah, but how many full-times did we have?
One.
We only have
more FTEs.
Because that's a discussion for another time.
Yeah.
Build
businesses.
We're not going to fee our way out of this, but
no.
We ought to be looking at fees.
But we shouldn't be leaving
money
on the table.
Well, we shouldn't be paying money out, quite frankly. I mean, a department like this should be covering itself. There's no two ways around it.
So other than the building, which I said, you know, the fee is probably okay, the $11 or $12. The methodology could be looked at. The reinspection fees could be looked at. Minimum fees. There's some areas we could look at. Plumbing and gas, you saw some ideas on that. Electrical's about the same. Planning, I mean, I'm really torn on planning because, you know, we don't charge for minor site plan review. We created minor site plan review so that we could expedite review of projects into daytime government. Mm-hmm. So whether it makes sense to add a fee for that or not, I'm really not sure.
Do the other communities charge for that? Or?
It depends.
Do they have it?
Some do, some don't. Some have it, some don't. It's kind of all over the map. We could look at our ANRs and our subdivisions, and those are probably in need of updating. Do we increase site plan review? I don't know. It's all good food for thought. I don't really know what the answer is. Conservation, definitely the fees could be increased across the board. Generally, those fees are below what other towns. Chuck did a lot of work on this, I think, a year or two ago. We come back to this from time to time. Anyway, I have a lot of data on that I could share. And, you know, human and elder services, do we charge for the van? I don't know. I feel very torn about that.
You'd have a hard time meeting the criteria of covering costs since it was donated.
You have the gas and you have the driver. And
you pay for gas and then you got to pay for operation.
Yeah, I mean, there are costs, but
you know,
costs, but there are some services that you should provide.
Exactly. I mean, I don't feel like we should be balancing it on the backs of the people that need
right.
it the most. But those are just some ideas that I've put on paper.
Yeah, and you know, that's one I'm
yeah.
not feeling very good about that fee.
So that's basically it. Anything else? Nuts and bolts about the budget. Our costs really haven't changed. There's a little bit of a wash when it comes to some extra allocation of funds for the economic development director's expenses. Same for the economic development director's position. Those are being offset by our permits revolving fund. The overtime has been reduced. We had a $30,000 line item for overtime. That's been reduced to $15,000. That's because our document scanning project now should be wrapping up in this fiscal year. And that's basically it as far as the nuts and bolts of the budget. I think I went over in pretty detail. Our budget is mostly salaries.
Right. Do we have a copy of your presentation somewhere?
No, but I
can. We have copies already written.
Okay. That was, you know, as were all the others, very informative. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you for your time, everyone.
Thanks, Steve.
Yep. Love that vote.
Are we ready for a motion?
Pardon me?
Are you ready?
That was it, right?
Yep. Are we ready to go?
We're done.
Are we ready? Did you have something in your mind?
Move to adjourn.
Second. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
We're out.